Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Resonance Arcade. It's Wednesday night, and we are live.
Hello.
Hello.
For those of you new to the show, we are three today, guys, of the north of England that talk about games. On a Wednesday at 7:30. Well, most Wednesdays, we haven't been around for the last couple of weeks.
So yeah, we haven't talked about games for a while, have we?
No, we haven't, and to be fair, there hasn't really been that much going on in my eyes. I mean, there's been a few announcements, a few releases. Most of the stuff, we're coming up to game releases now, aren't we? The season is about to start. Speaking of things about to start, Metal Gear Solid 4, 5, 4. What the fuck is wrong with me?
Oh,
45.
Metal Gear Solid 5 is out on Tuesday, in fact, 1st of
really?
September. Yes, and we haven't even played 4 yet on our other stream.
Yeah,
and I'm on holiday, so I've booked my yearly holiday, my yearly vacation on the day that the one game that I want for the entire year is coming out. So I'm got
something
to look
forward. Means you enjoy it more. It's like waiting for Sunday dinner, Chris.
Well, the thing that you know what I'm not too bothered because I was going to wait to see if it was any good on PC before I. You know, before I take the plunge on the PS4 or the PC, I'm not sure yet. If it's got terrible reviews on PC, then I'm just going to go for the PS4 version, bugger it. But I don't know. I feel like I need to play this on the PC for some reason. But anyway, hello, welcome to everybody in chat. Welcome to Mythalor. Welcome to Wut, and there's a few other people hanging around that haven't said anything yet, I believe. And welcome to Lou and Sam as well. Sam's not been around for a bit, so that's why we've not really done the show.
Yeah.
Shall we start?
Yeah. Let's start.
Games. Which games have you guys been playing?
Sam.
I've only got one, but I actually have played a game for the first new game that I've not played before for the first time in about what feels like 3 months. It's a game called King's Quest. It's the first part of a sort of ongoing downloadable story, a bit like the Telltale Games did with The Walking Dead. So there's like 5 chapters. And this is the first one. It's called A Night to Remember. For those of you that may or may not know, King's Quest is quite an old school, long running adventure game series.
I was going to say it's
from Sierra,
isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, and they sort of done a modern update about this. So the main character, you know, King Graham, who was in the old games, is sort of as an old man, voiced by Christopher Lloyd, which is just awesome, telling a story to his grandkid about his adventures. So he starts out really young. And you go and like have a little tutorial thing where you try to nick a piece of treasure from a dragon and stuff. And it's really nice. It's really quite an enjoyable game, like absolutely overflowing with charm as well, which I like. You know, a lot of sort of humour. The animations on the characters are really funny, very, you know, you can tell there's a lot of Monty Python and the Princess Bride kind of like influence to the style of humour and the personalities of the characters in the game.
So it is a comedy game, is it?
Yes, I would say it's an adventure game that definitely leans towards comedy the same way that, like,
Monkey Island and
Monkey Island would do. Yeah, yeah. It's definitely, if you like Monkey Island, it's that kind of game. But it has a few different mechanics in it as well. There's a little bit where you have a race, there's a little bit of archery where you just do, like, you have to hit certain targets, nothing particularly complicated. Lovely, lovely looking game as well. Such a nice cell shading kind of style, but really lovely color palette. Great design on the characters and things.
I played the original. There's actually quite a lot of King's Quest games. There's not just the one, I think.
Five or six, I think.
Was it on the Amiga? Because I've definitely played them.
It could be. They are pretty damn old. Like, it's an old series.
Checking now.
Cool adventure games, anyway. But I mean, yeah, I'm just looking at it now, showing it out on the stream, and it looks quite cool. Yeah.
84, the first game came out.
Oh, wow, that's the year I was born. Jesus, that's crazy.
And it was on the Amiga and the ST and all the other old machines.
Yeah. So, yeah, you can sort of tell the kind of presentation that the game's got. It is that old adventure game thing where you find, like, a button on the ground and then meet a bloke who's like, oh, I've lost a button, and then you give it to him. Well, you find someone who, like, wants a wheel for their cart, so you give them a big loaf of bread. But they can make it to a wheel. You know, it's kind of like you just pick a weird item and see if it works.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I like. I enjoy that kind of stuff.
I've always enjoyed that, yeah.
So would you be interested in that, Chris?
I I haven't got time for adventure games these days. That's the problem. I do really enjoy them. I've got maybe about three or four currently in my Steam list. One's called The Banner Saga. I've got another one called Tale of Two Sons. Brothers, Tale of Two Sons, and it's an indie game. I've just been, I nearly started playing that last Friday, actually, but that's not really, I think it's more of a platformer adventure.
A puzzle sort of game, isn't
it? It's a puzzle game. But it's the two brothers, and you have to do each of the skills to solve puzzles.
Yeah, it's like a twin stick type thing, and it sounds quite interesting, but last weekend we were looking for games to play, me and the wife, and that was one of them that's on the shortlist, essentially. And I've got another few, the Deponia games I've got to play yet. And a few more anyway, but it's another one that would probably just sit in my Steam list until I'm 50 or something.
What you're saying is you're waiting for it to be in a sale, aren't you?
No,
that's what you're saying.
No, I'm not, because I played the original King's Quest and I don't really want to play another one. You know, I'm happy. And if I want to go and play an adventure game, I've got about two more Monkey Island games that I haven't actually played yet that I really do want to play.
Yes.
Before I go any further. So is that the only thing you played then, Sam? Have you?
It is. I haven't been back to The Witcher 3. I haven't played on a computer that much just because I've had been working quite unsociable shifts. So I just, when I get in from work, I don't play it. I haven't been playing before I go to work, so I just haven't been playing much at all. Yeah. Just been watching a few TV shows and watching a few movies, not playing games. Apart from that one, the first part of it, I got a good 4 or 5 hours of gameplay out of it, which I thoroughly enjoyed.
Also, it's coming out in parts, sorry, you said?
Yeah, so it's part one is only out now. It's not played all of it yet. It's not even available all of it yet. It's
episodic then, right?
They did that with The Walking Dead, where you had chapter one, chapter two, and so on.
I'm a bit out of touch with what's coming out and you know, what's out on in series, because there's quite a lot of games, especially indie games, that are coming out that are in parts. There's another one that I was looking at called Life is Strange, which I think we've had a guest on before talking about it.
Seen bits of that. It looks interesting, that game.
It does, yeah. I'm tempted.
I'm not sure if it's a bit wanky, but it could be good. Do you know what I mean?
Like,
it looks a bit pretentious, but it could be quite good.
But it actually looks... I mean, I've been looking at quite a lot of reviews for it, and it sounds like something I'd quite enjoy. It's you play with time in it as well, don't you? You can reverse time.
Yeah.
It's again on the shortlist.
Yeah.
So Lou, what have you been playing apart from the game that we've both been playing to death?
Right, so the other game that I've been playing is a game called Power Slave EX. Now, this is a game that came out a long time ago called Power Slave. It was released in the UK as Exhumed, and I got it for the PlayStation. I got it with the sole purpose of, I was really hyped about getting Duke Nukem. And I didn't have a PC at the time. And this game, Power Slave, or Exhumed as it was called over here, was said to be using the same engine as Duke Nukem. So I bought the game based on the fact that it might be a bit like Duke Nukem. And it turned out about a really good first-person shooter with a kind of Metroidvania sort of thing to it, in that you would go back to levels with new abilities and be able to go to new places in it. So there's a bit of footage going there. It's really smooth, actually, and the movement's really nice in it. It's full 3D, like, so quick.
Is this a new game?
No, this is a remake of this console version of the game.
Right.
So the game that came out on the PC was the build engine, the Duke Nukem engine, and it was a very different game. So some guy has basically, from scratch, rebuilt the game.
Right.
Using the original assets and allows you to play on a PC, and it's great. It's really good.
And he's got the license to do that, or out of license, or
he hasn't. This is the problem. You cannot download this game from his website.
There was actually, just before I started this video, there was a pop-up that said you can no longer download this game. I didn't read the full thing. Go on.
Unfortunately, yeah, you can't get hold of it. If you do find a way to get hold of it, then it is a very, very good game. If not, get hold of Exhumed from a second-hand shop on PlayStation, whack it in an emulator or something. It's really worth playing. It's probably the closest thing I can compare it to is the Metroid Prime games. It's a Castlevania 3D sort of game.
Right.
But it is a great game, and
it definitely has the look of Duke Nukem and Doom, and you know.
Yeah.
does, but it's like the engine's fully 3D, which is the interesting part. Yeah. They actually use this engine to do the Quake, the conversion of Quake on the Saturn.
Right.
But yeah, I don't know how I came across this, but I did really enjoy this game back in the day. It's a challenging game. There's a lot of kind of exploration, going back and finding places. It's very much like the Metroid sort of thing. But yeah, PC version of it.
How much have you been playing?
I've played about a quarter of the game already, in fact.
Yeah.
In the times that I've been able to get on it, I forgot how good it was. And now I really want to play some other PlayStation first-person shooters, like Disruptor.
Really? Console first-person shooters, though? I mean...
This works very well on PC. I'd like to see someone remake Disruptor on the PC, because this has got proper mouse and keyboard controls.
I was just about to say you wouldn't have, you wouldn't be able to aim this the way that this person is in the video, at least.
No, on the
PlayStation.
It was auto aim on the PlayStation, and it worked pretty well. It kind of auto looked up and down, and you could control that as well. Good game, though. Very, very good game.
Whenever I see first-person shooters from that era, I always think, wow, look at how fast you can move. You notice that, like, loads of modern FPSs make you sort of walk at less than a jog speed. I've really started to notice it in a couple of first-person games from the Xbox 360, PS3 era, when it felt like my normal movement speed was so slow. And then I had to run, straight sprint for, like, 10 seconds and then recharge it. I kind of do miss that old, like... just fucking legging it, like, first-person shooter speed.
Duke Nukem and Doom, you move very fast. I think in certain instances of a Doom, if you slide against a wall, you can be going at the equivalent of about 90 miles an hour or something. It's pretty ridiculous. Yeah.
Well, in Quake, it was like that as well. You just felt like you were shifting it around the levels a lot faster.
It slowed it down quite a bit in Quake.
It still felt faster than today's games.
Yeah, it does, yeah. I mean, today's games, you're basically like you're walking around like a leper. The actual gameplay in modern first-person shooters has gone more towards gunplay. Like, if you look at Counter-Strike, for instance, Counter-Strike is all about the gunplay and about the aiming and the use of the weapons.
Mm. Which is, I would dare say, probably more what it's like in real fights. It's not about licking it really fast into a sea of monsters and shooting them with rockets, as it was in the olden days.
I just found out I was muted for a little bit. Then
that's
sorry,
all right. No one cares about what you say.
No. It was only brief. I was trying to stop my caterwauling keyboard from bothering the crowd while you guys were talking. But I will not do that from now on. So if I'm typing away, I'm not being rude. I'm just setting things up for
people at home. Feel free to fill in Chris's dialogue for him.
Just put some captions up. It's usually blah 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 beard 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 blah blah beard beard.
Pretty much.
I want to merge your entire family, apparently, according to LA Gamer for Life in chat.
I think you should try and do that in the actual voice that he's wanting you to do. I think this is maybe a fetish.
I was doing some voiceover work for when we did the LD Jam. Couple of weeks ago, and the people in that, well, a couple of months back, we did, me and Lou did LD32, and I was doing some devil voices for the game. And I obviously use modulators and stuff to make it even lower and more like Doom ridden, but everyone was going, You're really good at that, you should do it for a living. I'm like, no, I'm awful at this. Go and listen to some real voice actors.
Those voices are pretty damn scary. I suggest anyone goes out and finds Charn Hell.
Yeah, Charn Hell.
You won't be able to work out how the hell to play it, but you'll get to hear Chris's beautiful voice. I'm my voice.
Yeah.
Doing weird grunting orgasms.
Yours is really good as well, though. Really. I thought it was... We didn't do many takes of it. It was really, really fun to do, I think. Sorry?
I was going to say, what are your lines? What lines do you say?
I think basically I'm the devil and I'm mocking everybody and I'm basically saying that they're all pitiful and pathetic. Pathetic's one of the lines, isn't it? Pathetic. Yeah.
Pathetic.
Yeah. But Lou did a few as well, but we again added some effects onto it. I think it sounds really good.
I am free. Something like that.
That's shit. It's on the LD Ludum Dare website if anyone wants it. Find the link, Lou, while...
I think the Ludum Dare is on again at the moment.
Just last weekend. It was, what was it? I Am the Monster, or You Are the Monster was the theme. I only caught it on about I don't know, maybe 3 or 4 o'clock on the Saturday. I think Mythalo in chat was actually doing the jam. Mythalo, tell us how you did with the Ludum Dare game jam. Be interested to see. Yeah, obviously they won't have given any points or score yet, but how did you get your game finished? So, I know we've got another game to talk about. We'll leave that till the end because I imagine we can do a little bit of spoofing about it.
Could do, yeah.
But I've played quite a few games this over the last couple of weeks. Most of these are actually in the first week of our little hiatus. First game was a game called Pixel Piracy that some of you may or may not have heard of.
I think you talked about it a couple of weeks ago and you just started playing it then or something.
Yeah, I did. I'm just going to put something on. So Pixel Piracy, it's a 2D pixel piratey up. Basically, you are a pirate, you're a captain, and you've got a few crew members. And the intention is for you to go around and raid islands. And so far, I can tell there's like 3 or 4 different types of scenarios, and it's in beta, it's like early access. There's an island, which is quite hard for you to take over. There's ships, different grades of ships that you can try and take over. And when you take over a ship, you have the option to send, as you upgrade your ship, you can get cannons and put it off. If you look what's on the screen now, that's the starting ship. It's just a really basic thing.
The dinghy.
Yeah, but in a minute you'll see the map, which is, there you go. And you can basically click on the map and go around in different places. And those little green ones are pirates to attack, I think. Sorry, the little green ones are the islands. The red ones are the pirates. This must be quite an early one, because some of the things that are going on the screen weren't going on mine. But you can also set all of your crew. If you see them things going across the top where it says boarders, gunners, ship crew, training, yeah, custom, that you can set your crew to be different groups, essentially. So you can leave all of your pirates. I've got a huge ship now, and I've got like 50 pirates on it, and I've spent maybe about 10 hours playing the game. And every time you take over, there's so many things going on. I can't figure out what to tell you about first, actually. He's boarding a ship right now, so there's just one pirate being sent on to board the ship. But eventually, you board a ship and there's like cannon fire going on all over the place. There's loads of people boarding your ship. You've got people who stay on your ship and defend. You've got people who stay on your ship and man guns. You've got people who stay on your ship just to clean up the shit. Like, literally, everybody poos constantly all over your ship. And there's just little piles of poo all over the place. It's quite funny. And the way that they clean it, you have to train them all. There's lots and lots of menus as well. There's lots of kind of statistics. Every single pirate, you can upgrade their skills, and every single pirate, it's very, very in-depth. It's kind of a pirate management sim, but it's it's really interesting. But I've got it to a point now where I've got this humongous ship, and it can't run. My ship's so big and complicated that the game isn't optimized enough, so it just stops. And there's a little percentage thing running up in the top right hand side now. When you go from place to place, depending on how far it takes you and how good your skills are of the crew members, this is it takes a different amount of time. And while you're moving, you get, you know, you have to feed your pirates, you have to clean up on the ship, you have to reload guns, you have to do all kinds of stuff. And I mean, these are tiny little ships that you're seeing now, but some of them are insane.
Do you directly control things then? Like when he's attacking next, is he actually doing that, or do you just click on a pirate and the old guy attacks on a timer?
You select your groups, so you select your groups with 1 to 6, and you can get animals as well, like cows and sheep and crabs and all kinds of stuff. But
unleash the crabs!
The crabs are actually really fucking good at killing people. You can send them on the. You can ride animals as well. He's just plundered a ship then as well, so he's actually got a lot of stuff from the ship because he blew it up afterwards.
Or the look of this game, really liking the look of this.
It's really beautiful as well. The look of there's nice reflections on the water. There's lovely backdrops. It's quite simple, but it gets ridiculous. Like I can't even remember where I got it from. I've had it for quite a while. And I randomly just tried to play it the other day, and I haven't had any recommendations or anything. But it's really good, really interesting. But you build your ship up when you've boarded at a village or a town or whatever. You can basically build your ship up from all of the loot that you've plundered, so you can end up with these humongous kind of ships. I might even have a screenshot somewhere that I've saved, but I'll.
Can you build up like a fleet?
No, just the one ship for now, I think. but you can build up a huge amount of pirates. And I mean, I've got some pirates that have like been with me from the very beginning of the game, and they're like level 50. I've got some that I've just recruited from a town, and they're level 2 and 3. So you can also train pirates as well while you're moving from place to place. You can train your pirates with various different skills. There's all kinds of skills as well. So when you've got your cleaning skill, you've got your fighting skill, you've got a load of special moves and stuff, but they're all kind of automated. So you send 50 pirates on a ship, or you might send 20 of your 50 pirates onto a ship, and you'll have to assign the right pirates to the right groups to, you know, with the right skills in order for them to. You've got plundering treasure as well. You've got digging on islands. It's an insane amount of detail, to be fair.
I really, really like the sound of this. I've seen it before, but I'd not really thought about getting it.
But... So here he goes. He's going onto a ship now. That first one, the version that I've got, you've got what each area is. So you've got shops, you've got pubs. In the pubs, you can recruit people. In the shops, you can buy things, obviously. Buy food and things like that. There's different types of shops as well, so only some islands have some shops on it. I've played it so much now, though, that I think I've kind of seen everything in the beta as things stand. So,
right.
But there's so much, again, so much in it, and there's lots and lots of different menus, as I said. Anyway,
do you build the ships yourself? Do you actually place them down block by block?
Yes, you can do that. Or when you say, for example, you come across a ship that's quite big or much bigger than yours, it's actually better if you, instead of plundering the ship and making it explode, you capture the ship. Yeah. And then it's yours, basically. So your other ship gets plundered and you get all of the loot off your other ship. But you can also place toilets on the ship to make things better. You can place training like things on the ships. You can each ground block on the ship, you can place one item. And it can be food, toilet paper, toilets, animals, animal pens. There's all kinds of stuff. Get it?
I think you've sold it.
He's on the net right now. He's buying skills from a shop, and see, you can get map reading, toilet study is one of the ones you have to give everybody. Otherwise, they just shit everywhere.
Toilet study.
Literally, basically, shit everywhere.
You need to toilet train your pirates.
Yeah, it's all procedural as well. So every single pirate is obviously unique in some way, but every single pirate has a little backstory as well, which is just a bit of text, but it's still funny. You know, it's like, this guy used to be a sales agent. You know, it's daft. It's just a bit daft. But yeah, I should have really took some... I did take some videos of my own ship, but I can't remember where I've put them now. So, but there, so you see all that steaming stuff on his ship now? That's all the poo. Because whoever's on the ship isn't assigned to the cleaning duty, and they don't have the toilet, or they don't have the cleaning skill thing on there. Anyway, it's good. It's good. It's worth it. It's worth definitely worth a go, and it. I think it's pretty cheap, so get on it.
Fair enough.
Just don't let your ship build up.
Yeah, don't let your ship build up anyway. Okay. Should we have a little bit of a talk about ours? Because I said I've got another 6 bloody games I can talk about.
Go on then, let's reveal the...
So we did a bit of recording, but unfortunately it failed us miserably. But Lou and I have been playing Minecraft.
Yep, how original are we?
Now, I know we're
now the people.
How have you found it?
Good. You know what, I thought I was going to hate it. I thought, Steve's not around to play Terraria, so let's give Minecraft a go, bugger it. And I got into it, and Lou's played it a bit more than me, so he kind of held my hand and took me through some of the basics, and... I didn't like the crafting system to start off with because it's quite different from anything I'm used to. But now I've got into it, I do quite like it. I think it's quite ingenious, actually. I love it. I'm the newest, biggest fan. And I thought I wouldn't. I really did think I'd hate it.
It has a certain something about it. It's something that nothing else has really captured since. And I'm not entirely sure what that something is. It's like it's done the things that it does right.
You know what it leans towards more than anything? It leans towards not the mining or the crafting. It leans towards building, especially the survival mode, building a little hamlet and living on it. Not necessarily getting to the end of the game, again, or getting into the nether, getting into the end, and then fighting the ender dragon.
I was going to say, is there like an end thing you have to do? So.
There is a goal, but you don't have to stop playing when you've done that goal. It's like Grand Theft Auto, and you can just keep going after that.
So I started a server. Well, Lou started a server originally. We started playing a little bit in that, but it was a bit flat and boring. So I mean, I started another server. Spent a bit of time figuring out how to set servers up properly and generated quite a nice looking world. So we started playing in that, and we've played God knows how many hours now in it. But we've
Do we have any screenshots of video or anything of our farm?
I might have taken I might have accidentally taken some screenshots because all of the F keys do something different, don't they, in Minecraft? But no, I don't know yet. But basically, we've got a little building with a little mushroom farm and a little pumpkin farm, loads of cows and sheep, and we're in survival mode, so we've just set up this world, and it's a lot of fun, and it's our little gay paradise, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It is very gay, actually.
I mean, there's flowers everywhere, you know?
Yeah.
It's ridiculous the amount of attention that Lou's put into this place. I've gone off and done the practical things. I'm the breadwinner here. I go out and I get the cows and the sheep. I mean, I know you did it originally in the first game we did, but I went out and got the cows, got the sheep. I haven't got any pigs yet. Managed to get a few horses. I'm breeding all the horses. I'm doing the farming stuff. I'm cutting up all of the wheat and the pumpkins and all that. And Lou's placing flowers, cutting hedges down and placing hedges and
making it look nice, making it look like a home rather than just a bloody
adding in
cuboid
beams
that we live in.
Adding in beams. I put a picture up.
You did. So, you did.
And I've created the little ender, not the ender, the nether gate, so you can get into the nether realm.
What was the picture of a cube?
What
was the picture of?
I don't know, every time you place it, it's random, it changes.
I can't remember what our one is, it's just some pixels on
a
canvas.
Sure.
Mythalore says it's F2 for screenshots, apparently, in Minecraft. But you know what, the reason I'm enjoying it so much is because I'm playing it with Lou, or playing it with a friend, rather. It's because I don't think I would enjoy it at all on my own. I mean, I've played a little bit on my own, but only to get us to a point. But I haven't really been inclined to play it without anyone around.
I've had this game since alpha, so I paid €5 for this game back in 2010, I think. And I actually gave my copy away to a friend's daughter, and I bought it again to play it with Chris. So I know what to do in the game, or I did know what to do in the game, but there's been a lot added since then. It doesn't have the density of content that Terraria has. Terraria has a lot of different, very, very different looking biomes. It's very unrealistic in that sense, and it kind of, that works in its favor. Whereas Minecraft has a more realistic world. A realistic world is made out of cubes, but the biomes don't differ that much. They're all variations on a theme of woodland or plains or whatever. And the actual amount of bosses and items and stuff is much lower than Terraria.
What do you mean, but much lower? It's immensely lower.
Yeah, it's hugely lower.
There's one boss, isn't there, Minecraft?
There's two bosses, technically.
Is there? All right.
Yeah. But it doesn't have the same progression. But like you say, the joy of it is in actually building a 3D world around you, and that's something very cool. That's something that appeals to me as someone, like a child who played with Lego and wanted to basically be inside the Lego, and that's what it is.
But everything that I do in that game is mechanical and practical, but that seems to be me in most kind of building games. I want to do something that's going to help us, or it's going to work in some way, you know?
Like Steve would be like that as well.
Yeah. I mean, it's like I tried to build a gate and a little drawbridge, but it failed miserably because of the way
it was vastly over-engineered. It looked like an aircraft hangar.
I don't think you can even do what I need to do. I'll try and explain it at some point, but I'm not sure I like all the red stone stuff, though. It's very, very, very complicated.
It's meant to be.
But does it need to be? I mean, what unless you're building a server and your server's an adventure server and you're going to be getting loads of people coming on following an adventure, you know, they're starting one point and then they're, you know, they run along a path or whatever and go and speak to someone and go and do this and go and do that, then I don't really see the point in any of the redstone stuff apart from maybe opening and closing doors.
I think it's a hobbyist thing. Like, it's a way to make contraptions. It's just like if you're playing with an Arduino or something like that, when you get to do it in the virtual world.
Well, Mythologia said Minecraft has gone much more for creative content than Terraria. You can do anything now from Kinect motion capture to building a computer. Now, he's right, that's what I mean. I've seen some crazy redstone stuff that you can do.
So what is the redstone stuff? I don't even know. I don't know anything about this.
In Terraria, you can basically connect switches to something like an activator, and an actuator will turn a block on or off. Or you can connect it to a statue, and it'll activate the statue. But you connect it with wire. Redstone is stuff that you mine, and it basically, it's like powder, but you can mine it again and pick it up again. It's weird, but you drop it, and it's like a gunpowder trail that you put onto many different types of blocks. Mythalos just mentioned a command block, which I haven't even started looking at yet, and the command blocks allow you
they're not in survival, they're only in creative mode.
Right, okay. So the command blocks allow you to essentially write in loads of different Minecraft commands, so you can basically get, once a block is activated by redstone via a switch or via maybe a minecart passing something, or I don't know, a piston hitting a block. There's millions of different things you can do with it. It's insane, the amount of things, in fact. But
it gives you all the tools you need to basically build circuits and proper logic gates and things, so you can build computers inside Minecraft.
Okay.
Using small basic parts.
And Sulukos just said, do you see Minecraft still being around in 10 years? I do. I do, because there's always going to be new people who will want to, new kids that are into that kind of thing. What happens with most games these days, right? Big games, AAA games, they either stay around for a good while because they've got good multiplayer content, or they disappear after a few months and no one plays them anymore ever again. Minecraft's been around for how long now? 10, 15 years? 10 years?
No, it's not been around 10 years. It came out in 2009, I believe, or 2010. Okay. So
coming up to 10 years, not too far off, really.
Six years.
The point is, though, although that's old for a game, and yet it's only just getting into its stride now, and it's only just reaching its target audience.
Also, remember, I know a lot of people aren't happy about it, but remember that Microsoft have picked it up, and Microsoft are also going to be promoting it with the HoloLens and all the other stuff that Microsoft will use it for. They haven't paid that amount of money to just leave it as it is. They're rewriting it, I imagine, in C++ or C#. They're dropping Java entirely, from what I can tell. That's what the Windows 10 version is, from what I can tell.
Yeah.
The language doesn't matter to me, but obviously they couldn't possibly keep it in Java with it being an Oracle technology.
I think the thing about Java is that there's a lot of mods for it already, and if they change it, then the mods won't work anymore.
No, but the community will pick those up probably. But
yeah,
they'll also, I think the old version is still going to be supported. I don't think it's just going to stop.
Probably, yeah.
I mean, if anything, it'll be unofficially supported, although I have seen quite a few DMCA takedown notices for various Minecraft mods and things like that. I'm not sure if that's come from Microsoft or from Mojang before Microsoft bought them. But like, for example, the Bucket server, which is a big like open source community mod for the Minecraft server. Anyway, let's not go too far into it. This isn't a Minecraft podcast, but I've enjoyed it.
There's plenty of them.
I don't know how much more I'm going to get out of it, though, I have to be honest. I'm starting to feel like we're kind of reaching the end of what we can get out of it.
We are. I mean, we are reaching the end of what the game content has to offer. There's not a lot. There's the fortresses and the other structures that we've not yet found, but there's not that much. Compared to Terraria, which is a content fest, Minecraft is much more what can you make with the stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I'd love to sit. I went in creative mode on my own little server, and I started to create a castle just for a laugh. But
well, when I saw that
to SQL. You know what? I bet some twat would do that. I bet there's an SQL like server version of Minecraft. There's every other bloody language has been used to write a Minecraft server, so why not?
So yeah, we've played Minecraft folks. We played Minecraft in 2015.
Yeah, it's about the first time I've ever really played it. I've turned it on a few times. I've had it on my mobile once or twice just to give it. I never got it. Never really understood it. But I literally gave it maybe 10 minutes each time and I didn't really go much further. But I'm glad that I've given it some of my time. I now understand what the fuss is about and I understand how powerful it is. And I don't know. I might revisit it a few times and we'll see how much more we get out of it. Probably got at least another few nights, maybe this week. Maybe.
We need to build that giant structure that we talked about, Chris.
Oh, yes. Yes, we do. Yes.
Is it a giant statue of a cock?
It might be.
It might be. But we're going to use it as the new Residence Arcade logo, whatever yeah. It is.
It'll be made okay. Out of obsidian because you need a dark material.
Yep. Okie dokie. So, Sulico's also said, asked, would Minecraft be usable with VR tech, do you think? Of course, why not?
I've used it with my Rift and it's really cool.
Well, we did that thing at E3 where they were showing the HoloLens Minecraft demonstration, which was quite impressive. So yeah, definitely. I think that I wouldn't be surprised if that's going to be one of their big things going forward, actually.
I think
how they incorporate Minecraft into the VR stuff and use it as a selling point for VR as well, possibly.
Well, what's amazing about being in VR in Minecraft, and it's just, you'd notice it with a lot of games, but it's the scale of stuff. Like, the blocks are a metre squared.
Hmm.
And it looks like a fucking metre squared block in front of you, whereas when you're playing a game, you get no sense of the scale.
The same applies to everything. When I played Half-Life, everything was fucking massive in VR. Yeah. I was like, Jesus Christ, how big is he?
Yeah.
I felt like that when I played Half-Life 2 very briefly on the Oculus. Felt really weirdly small. Felt like I was only 2 foot tall.
You know, there's a bit. You know, when you fall out of the first window and you land on the box and the box breaks. Yeah. That window. When I looked down on the Oculus, I looked down and I was like, "I'm not going down there. I'm not having that. I'm gonna break my face."
Yeah.
Minecraft does that to you. It does other things. It does claustrophobia to you. Like, you'll go into a little cave.
Oh man!
Get rid of the water, and you're in this tiny little.
And get attacked by zombies.
We don't get attacked. Just actually to have the ceiling that far above your head.
Yeah, I don't think I'd like that.
That's freaky.
But you do get attacked by, is it at night time, these weird zombie creatures?
Yeah, or in the dark, they'll spawn anywhere.
I also now know what a creeper is as well. And I've, you know, the creepers, everyone who loves Minecraft knows what a creeper is. Never knew how much of a bastard they were. Now, the worst thing about them, not dying, not them creeping up on you and killing you, it's the fact that they somehow always manage to get inside your fucking house and explode behind you while you're crafting something. So these creeper things, they're just literally, they don't make any noise apart from that's it. And and you have to rebuild your house every bloody time they do it as well. So you have to be very careful about how much light is around in your compound. So you've got little fences everywhere, but if they'll spawn if there's not enough light somewhere. Yeah. So it's a bit annoying. It's a good mechanic though. I quite like that.
It is.
I've also got my my tree farm as well going on, which is just a solid block of wood for about 25 meters squared. It's ridiculous. Anyway, let's move on from Minecraft.
Well, we will show some pictures next week if anyone's interested. We might even record a bit of video of us running around our farm, giving them the tour.
Yeah, I did do a little bit of streaming on my own, in fact, but no one came on. And to be fair, I wasn't really that bothered about it at the time. So, okay, shall I quickly run through the other games that I've I've been playing. So, a game called Rainmaker.
Reign Maker.
Yeah, Regain Maker.
Regain Maker.
Regain Maker.
Reign as in of a king. Maker. Yeah.
Yes.
It's awful. It's awful.
It looks terrible. It looks like Candy Crush with some.
It is now. I again got it in some bundle somewhere, and I thought, oh, it's in my Steam list. Let's have a go. And it's basically it's trying desperately to be a kind of an RTS, but. Without any, I love the mini game element of being able to. You can play threes and basically shoot loads of shoot enemies that are coming towards you. So it's like a tower defense with threes when you go into battle mode. But all of this stuff that you're looking at right now, this is just basically click on a thing, and then when you've got enough of enough food or enough gold and enough experience, you can upgrade this bit.
That's Facebook game sort of thing.
It is, yeah. It's kind of like a Facebook. It's just bollocks. It's just not good. And it's, again, lots and lots of free, you know, it's a free-to-play game, I believe. Actually, I'm not, you know what? It isn't, because I got it in a Humble Bundle, so it can't be free to play. I think the one thing that made me get it is this. Now, let me try and find it.
The fact that you're an awful person, that's what made you get it.
So here we go. We're going into a battle now. So in your battles, this is the again, once you've decided to take over another part of the map, it allows you to match three, and then whatever three you match, it shoots out like water, fire, or ice, or earth elements, and they attack the people that are coming towards you. It's quite novel. The idea is interesting, and I saw someone play it on Twitch. This is just reminding me exactly why I got it, because I saw someone play it on Twitch, and I was like, actually, it looks quite cool, but it's not. It's not, and I should have watched the whole game, because the rest of it is useless. Come on, stop reading things, you rubbish YouTuber. There we go. So you match like...
Oh, I see.
You match... What's he going to do here?
So you've got the tower defense style. Oh, God, you got a bit of Guitar Hero going on there as well, haven't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, that kind
looks
of
a bit
thing.
Like it, actually.
It's,
yeah.
it's not really like that, but it's more of a Candy Crush crossed with a tower defense game, crossed with an RTS game. It's trying to be too many things at once, but every single element is very simple.
Anyway. See, that game on its own, that part, that mini game there would be quite fun on its own, maybe.
Yeah, but there has to be some context to it, doesn't it, I suppose? Or they have to kind of go, right, you built up to this.
Just tower defense with match three in it would be fine. Like, if you had a match three attached to Plants vs. Zombies, that'd be a perfectly serviceable game.
And you also, you buy troops as well that you can send into the battlefield, or you can spawn in the battlefield. And again, I
sounds like it's doing too much.
It's trying to do too much, but this whole bit here where you're managing your town, it's just useless. I mean, I said I didn't give it that much time, but it just wasn't very interesting. But anyway, let's move on from that. Let's move on from that.
I does not get the C-Box seal of approval, that one.
No, and neither does the next game that I'm going to talk about, Contraption Maker. Now, this is another one that's... I don't know why I've got these games. I don't know where they've come from. But it's a construction game that basically does everything for you. You've got all of these different components. Like, you've got fans, and you've got pulleys, and electrical switches, and things like that. But if you see, it's... I'm just not even playing.
It's very Heath Robinson sort of thing, isn't it? This is by the people who did The Incredible Machine, isn't it?
I'm not sure. It was, again, too simple, though. It was too, like, I did about 15 levels, and it was still holding my hand after the 15 levels, and I was like, come on. It's interesting that they've got all of these little things working together, but I don't know, again, just doesn't seem interesting enough. So it's like Mousetrap. It's probably the best way to say it. It's like Mousetrap, but lots of different types of levels, and it just feels a bit cheap. Yeah.
It looks doesn't look great.
It looks like a sort of nice enough idea, but the sort of really sort of stock image backdrops and the execution does look quite lackluster, I guess.
And I thought, again, with it being a construction game, I think I probably got it with a Humble Bundle construction pack at some point, because there was one that came with quite a lot of different like a couple of 3D games as well, and yeah, it's just, I don't know, yeah, not my thing.
Oh well,
but
they
again
tried,
that's,
didn't
that's
they?
Been uninstalled ASAP now. This is a game that I played that I've been enjoying. It's called Revenge of the Titans. This is a... It's the best way to describe it. I suppose it is a real-time strategy to an extent, but it's really nice looking, and it's it's a interesting kind of take on it. Now, what the hell? I'm trying to load a video and it's just one screen. Basically, you have to defend your base from these massive titans that look like cats, essentially. And the titans change as they go along, and there's quite a cool story to it. It's all kind of futuristic. It's dead simple. I think it's an indie game. The look of it's dead simple, but it's also quite smooth as well. And you essentially have to upgrade your titans, or you have to upgrade your base and get a load of extra... get a load of extra skills and stuff as you go along, so you can, as I said, you can buy a repair drone that repairs your base, and it's like a Command and Conquer crossed with a tower defense game again.
Okay.
But I really like the look of it as well, and
this looks nice, isn't it?
The story's a bit daft, and I think this is a boss fight. It took me a while to do this one actually. Those little things, those little arrows, are where the titans are coming from. And you have to gather resources from little crystals around the base, but you have to put resource extractors around those little crystals, and you have to defend your central base. Now, I'm sure as it gets further along, there'll be more than one base, and you'll have tons of new types of things. But if you just watch the Steam kind of promotional video, it's really quite interesting. You can have sensors, you can create sensors and turrets and rocket turrets and ICBM missiles and all kinds of stuff. I'm not sure what he's doing here, to be fair. He's just made a load of sensors and he's putting down a rocket turret, I think. So maybe there's a skill to that. As the Titans start attacking, obviously the turrets will automatically start attacking them. But you're supposed to defend it from all angles. So he must have something in mind here, this guy. He must be a
pro. So is this basically like a tower defense game then? But it looks like it's a tower defense game without lanes or without a clear track.
I suppose you could class it as a tower defense game.
Is it passive in the way that you attack things? You basically build turrets and the turrets attack them?
Yes.
I think it is. It's fair to call this a tower defense game.
Yeah.
Really?
Well, I quite enjoyed it, but I like occasional tower defense games. I think they're quite...
I like them if they're slightly different, yeah. This looks quite interesting.
This is quite... I don't know. Again, this guy's been very precise. Normally, you just fucking whack a load of turrets around and just let them attack. I think
he's plotting something special.
Yeah, this is a boss fight, actually. So this will be... I mean, I'll have half of these turrets that he's building I've never seen before. So I've only played maybe 2 hours of this. Let's move it on a little bit.
Let's skip to the bit where things explode.
Let's get to the Titan actually being there and attacking him.
What the hell?
So yeah, he's still building stuff. There we go, there's some Titans. They're only little Titans, though. So I bet the boss is huge when it comes. Oh, there he is.
Whoa.
Jesus Christ.
Hey.
So he's being held by something there. So that's a turret I haven't seen yet. It's really good sounding as well. Oh, he's just crushing turrets.
That's what bosses do. It looks pretty cool, actually. I know that I can see the action kicking off. I quite like it. The colour palette's nice. It looks nice.
I've been enjoying it, put it that way. I'm quite enjoying it. And your resources deplete as the map moves on. The games that I've played so far haven't really lasted that long, but it looks like... I mean, this is quite a long game. What, he's in 10 minutes into it, I suppose. And he's still fighting the boss, so... Jesus Christ. Yeah, I mean, I've got normal turrets, heavy turrets, and rocket turrets. That's it so far, so... Obviously, this is
some freaking lasers going on there.
Yeah, this is quite a bit further.
Nice effects. I quite like the visual style of it. It's really nice.
It is nice, isn't it?
But yeah, again, another one I'd recommend if you're into this kind of game. The thing I liked about it is that I can turn it on occasionally just to, you know, just to have a quick game or something.
Yeah, this is what I liked about Geo Defense on my iPhone, was that it was a really good tower defense game that you could play very casually.
Yeah.
10-minute burst, you'd have to sit there for 2 hours and get a session. Just play it for a little bit.
But yeah, Revenge of the Titans. Go for it if you're
I've noticed a lot of Titan seems to be a very popular word these days.
Does it? I was noticing. I was thinking, God, not another game with Titans in it.
Yeah, Titanfall, Titan Souls, Revenge of the Titan, Attack on Titan, your mum's a Titan. my knob's as big as a Titan. So on and so forth.
Titan's Titan.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I mean, I have actually completed a game as well for the first time in fucking ages.
Crikey, how did it feel to watch the credits roll on something?
Well, as soon as the credits rolled, I actually felt really, really uneasy and smashed my TV into bits. I couldn't cope with it.
I think you felt really queasy then. Did you just vomit?
Yeah. No, The Last of Us Remastered. I finished it.
I thought you must have been getting right near the end the last time we were on.
Basically when I posted a thing on Facebook about the giraffes that you were talking about a good while ago.
Yeah.
And it's not too far after that, the end, is it really?
You're pretty much right there.
But again, I kind of wish you hadn't told me about it because I was waiting for it the entire game. I was spending the entire time waiting for that moment and it didn't really have any impact on me when it came.
The reason it has an impact is just because of the context in which it happens as well, not necessarily the moment itself, but the things that happen before and after it as well.
But let's not go too far in it. But yeah, I've completed the game. It took me a while because I've only been playing it with the wife on Friday nights occasionally if we haven't been watching something. And she thoroughly enjoyed watching it as well. I started playing the DLC as well.
Left Behind.
Left Behind, right. Yeah.
Really, really, and really enjoyed that DLC. There's a lot of... Because it's split, as you might... I don't know how much of it you've played, but it's sort of split between quite serious gameplay and more sort of dicking around gameplay. With the flashback stuff?
I've played a bit of flashback stuff. I've played maybe two flashbacks into it, but I'm a bit bored and I can't be arsed with it, I'll be honest with you.
Fair enough.
But I think I made a mistake with it because I thought, I've just completed the game and I completed it on hard, or the one up on top of hard. So I put it on the uber realistic, ridiculously hard setting.
Shouldn't have done that.
I might just start it again. Oh, no, actually, you can lower your setting, the difficulty in the middle, can't you?
You can do it, I think, as you're playing it,
It's not the whole lack of resources or anything that's a problem when you put it on that setting for me. It was the fact that literally, if you get anywhere near a zombie, it can hear you no matter what you do, and it runs after you, and it's like, how do I even do this?
Bit? Well, there are ways. They don't hear you all the time. You just have to be really, really careful.
I was pressing forward the least Chris, amount of forward that
we,
I could possibly...
Chris, we know your track record with stealth.
You can fuck off with that.
You fucking ran into the room, headbutted them, and thought, how did you see me?
If you played it on Grounded, and I think on the one below Grounded as well, you don't get the listen mode, but also it removes the button prompts. So when you move up behind something, the distance that you can then grab them from behind doesn't tell you that you can do that. You have to just know it. It's kind of like that button prompt is gone, so you've got to then remember. So you have to play it after I've already played the game once. Like, you have to know the mechanics quite well. I found Grounded, and I've played Last of Us a few times. I found Grounded excessively like difficult. It was really fucking frustrating in places.
So I think I'll either start it again or if we will. I don't think Sal's too bothered about it either. So, but anyway, yeah, completed it. Good, happy, chuffed. Actually, you know, not a bad game at all. Really enjoyed the whole experience.
Cool.
Apart from a few bits where it forced me down particular routes. In fact, most of the game does that. Most of the game is very, very linear, and I hate linear games in general. I think there's very few linear games I enjoy. But that's me.
Yes, it does force you to. Yeah, there's certain situations where you try and sneak out of it, and you can't. You have to get into a firefight in order for it to forward the story, rather than enabling you to actually play the way you want to. Sometimes it happens like maybe three times in the game, but each one of those times is quite jarring. The rest of the time, the encounters you can kind of get through as you like. You can choose to engage or not in most situations. It's in my mind, you can sneak past everybody or you can fight everybody.
Yeah, I mean,
most of the time you can do that.
I preferred to at least clear a bit of a route if I didn't kill everybody in the room. But it all depends on who it was. I mean, the clickers. Oh my god, the clickers.
Oh, yeah, there's a good technique to killing the clickers. And I might have told you this a while ago, but a really, really, really useful technique is to always have a bottle or a brick on you and a melee weapon, but don't use your melee weapon all the time. So any enemy in the game, if you throw a bottle or a brick at them, including clickers, You can then one hit them with a melee weapon, which is just so goddamn useful. Oh. So if you know there's a clicker somewhere, throw a bottle at it, smack it with a pipe, it's dead. Then go and hide whilst the rest of the infected all come round for the noise, and then just pick them off one by one afterwards.
Mm.
Really, really useful tactic and quite fun. It's one of those little tricks that never gets old, because you smack them and the head just explodes and you're like, yeah. Anyway.
Yeah. I think I probably did that by accident a few times, but no, I didn't use that technique too much.
That's my favourite technique in that whole game. I do it all the time.
Yeah. My favourite technique was turning it off, because it really frustrated me at times. And the only other game that I've played, apart from Minecraft with Lou, is Witcher 3. And I am actually, I think I've saved just now. I'm level 33. I've got 100 experience to level 34. And level 34, you can get the Mastercrafted gear for most of the armor sets, I think, or if not all of them. And I want to get to level 34 before I do the final battle. And I think I'm on the final battle. Have you finished it, Sam?
I haven't played it for ages, mate. Right. I've done quite a lot on Skellige, but I need to go back to it. But I've got a feeling now that a Metal Gear 5 is coming out, I'm going to probably not go back to it for a while. Shit, because I want to complete it.
I forced myself to go back to it because I've been playing Terraria and Minecraft so much. I've not really been in the same kind of frame of mind for Witcher. Don't get me wrong, I still think it's an amazing game, and I've been enjoying the last week I've been playing it again. Excuse me. And yeah, I think I'm literally just about to fight the final bad guy. And I've really been enjoying the ending of it, actually. Even though it feels a little bit drawn out and a little bit kind of, right, go to the next place, fight this boss, go and fight these bosses, then go and fight this boss, and then go and collect some allies, and then go and fight this boss. And it's like, oh, come on, just get me to the end. I want it to finish now.
Yeah,
but I think I'm finally there. But I'm still enjoying it.
You probably get there first. I don't know where Steve's up to with it at all. But if you get there first, let us know how you feel about the ending and stuff.
Steve said that he saved just before the end and he's went back to The Witcher 1 because he doesn't really want to finish it. He's got anxiety or something.
I have that total feeling whenever I get into a thing, like whenever I recently read through the Harry Potter books again. And when I got to the end of the last one, I was like, I don't kind of want it to get to the end now, though. I wanted to get to the end, but you kind of don't, because you don't want to leave the experience. The same if I watch The Wire again and I get to the end of The Wire, I'm like, I don't want, there's only two episodes left, I don't want it to stop, I want it to keep going. It's that thing where you like don't want it to stop.
My wife bought me for our third wedding anniversary, which is leather or crystal. She bought me Breaking Bad for our crystal wedding anniversary, which I thought was quite good. And
crystal,
yeah, third is crystal.
That seems like quite a high up like there's, thing.
There's two. There's. I think there might be a later crystal as well in the original kind of traditional wedding list, but because sometimes it's quite difficult. I mean, how many people are going to be able to find something leather to buy somebody? You know, I mean, I've bought something.
Isn't the first one wood?
First one's paper in the traditional. I'm not sure about modern. Second one is linen. Second one's linen. Third one is leather in the traditional, but the third one's also crystal in new.
Which one's modern. The lava one?
Lava. Yeah.
Lava wedding anniversary.
I don't know, but anyway, yeah. So she got me Breaking Bad on Blu-ray. So I'm quite enjoying rewatching them. And we're watching all the extras as well as we go through the series. It's quite interesting, again, to listen to the director's take on things and Bryan Cranston going, well, I thought Walter White should do this at this point, so this is why I did this, etc.
Yeah, he's quite amusing in interviews, Bryan Cranston and stuff. He's quite a funny guy. Anyway, we digress quite a lot.
Has anybody else played any other games?
No, I don't think so.
No, that's it.
No, so for next time,
Metal Gear Solid Fest 2015.
We might as well tell everybody that we're not going to do the show every week from now on. We're going to kind of just pick and choose when we want to do it. At least three of us need to be here, I think. Because the last couple of weeks, both Sam and Stee have been busy. And as you can see, Stee is busy today. And at the moment, arranging guests is a bit difficult for me because I've got quite a lot of other things going on in my life. So we're just gonna play it by ear. And I think, to be fair, it gives us a little bit more content to play with every week as well, every time we come on.
Yeah. Worth has just mentioned Rocket League. Now, we've had a discussion about Rocket League, yeah, haven't we?
It's Carball. It's not Carball. 2000 anymore.
Yeah, I actually made a map that got into the official roster for Carball, which was a mod for Unreal Tournament 2004, and it is exactly the same game.
Have you played
it? So basically, that Lou's just saying that he invented Rocket League.
Have you played Rocket League?
I'm saying that I had a massive influence on it, probably.
Have you played Rocket League, Lou?
I haven't played it, but I've seen enough of it to know that it's exactly like Carball.
It looks exactly like it. I haven't played it either, and I've had so many of my gaming acquaintances say to me, play Rocket League, but I just don't think I'll enjoy it.
Are we so old now that we're in this cyclical nature thing where we've played all these games 10 years ago?
Yeah.
Probably.
Because we have. We've played the shit out of that game, and we liked it, but... Because the community then was so niche, and it cost so much to have a powerful gaming rig, and there was no console version of it, no one played it apart from us.
Mm.
Look at it, it's Carball!
It is just Carball, and we played so much of this back in the day, didn't we? I mean, Carball is a Unreal Tournament mod.
Where you drove cars around and hit a ball like this, and you could do flips, and you could pick up weapons. It's the same bloody game!
But no one cares because it's new and modern and that's what the kids like.
But then by your own admission though, Carball was a mod for a game for a niche market. So the fact that someone's going, hey, let's take this like quite cool idea that happened a while ago, make it into a full-fledged title, fucking fair play to them.
Right,
people enjoy it.
I'm
going to
do the same with Rocket Arena then, because Rocket Arena was niche and amazing and it should be a fully-fledged game on its own.
Do it then, if you want to. No one's stopping
can't
you.
Can't be asked. I haven't got time. It does, though. It doesn't look like it's anything different at all. It just looks like exactly the same thing. I
do hope that they've credited whoever made Carball.
Oh, I don't know.
Because...
They probably haven't.
There's no way that this game... whoever made this game has not seen Carball, because it plays exactly like it.
If it was a mod... then it wouldn't have had any kind of IP licensing or anything like that. It'll have just been a community-driven thing and people can rip it off as much as they want.
Mm.
Probably. I mean, I don't know if there was any a EULA involved with it or anything like that.
I'm just watching this and I'm just seeing... Like, you can probably do the combos and stuff. Yeah, you can jump and things. Oh... But yeah, you're right, Sam. Fair play to them. They've resurrected the concept and it's actually done well.
Yeah, it looks like it's quite a nicely made game. It's like, it looks nice. I don't know how it plays, but it looks quite smooth. Like, I don't know if I'd enjoy it, but it looks like they've...
It's a good LAN game.
I think Potato is about 10, 15 years old, you know. The way that he talks about Rocket League being an amazing game, I just don't think he's been around for that long.
And another one that I played the hell out of before it was cool, because I'm not trendy, was Defense of the Ancients in the form of Aeon of New Era for Warcraft 3.
Defense of the Ancients.
Yeah, Dota.
Oh, right.
League of Legends, Dota. Those games, I was playing them ages ago. I was playing them as a Warcraft 3 mod.
Do you need to get like a beard and some big glasses to put on when you say that? Be like, oh, I was playing Rocket League and fucking Dota before it was mainstream.
I remember when all these sold out. Were fields.
It's interesting that they're going back and mining these, and probably it is probably a good thing that they're doing this because they were great games. They were a lot of fun. Having said that, you look at the community that's evolved around League of Legends and Dota and things like that. Horrible, toxic communities.
Isn't every online community toxic and horrible?
Yeah, but when there were small communities, you look at the Rocket Arena 2 community that we used to be part of, and the
CS has got a pretty good community.
What?
the worst toxic community on the planet. Or when I used to
League of Legends got the worst, apparently.
Yeah.
League of Legends community is terrible. I know people still play Dota, but people play the modern versions of it now.
Well, anyway. Shall we move on to the Way of the Exploding List?
Yeah, there you go. All right, Lou. It's not an episode of Star Trek, mate. Calm down. Captain, you must fight back.
Has anyone got any ideas? Now, the Way of the Exploding List, to those of you who may be watching who are new, is a short section where we talk about something from games in a list format for about 15 minutes. So that may be favourite protagonist, that may be worst game that Lou likes, it could be most favourite scenery in a game, favourite soundtrack. I've got one thing.
Mythalos mentioned one there, which is most promising demo, prototype, or game jam game.
Oh God!
Now I've got to admit, I didn't even know what the theme was for this Ludden Dare.
I think I'd be struggling with that. Unfortunately, I've been so far out of the loop with game dev at the moment. I'm embarrassed to say it. I have to say, I'm going to get back into it. I've just been updating everything and getting Unity up to date and making sure everything compiles on subnet, so I'm going to get back into it, but I just haven't been following it recently.
I think I'll be able to appease that question in the form of some of the things that I'm going to mention in the news, because there's some quite interesting prototypes and upcoming games in there that will be pretty cool.
So I've got an idea.
Go on, then.
Which is, again, not particularly great, but worst voiceovers / voice actors.
Ooh.
In a game.
Okay. You've got to mention the first Resident Evil.
Oh, yeah.
When you talk about that shit.
Go on, give some quotes.
Maybe that's Chris. Barry! Where is Barry? All these, like, it's the animations as well. They go with it. That was too close. You were almost a chill sandwich. So many, like, amazing... Oh, the whole game is just incredible for that. Apparently, the story behind that is that because for the English translation of the game, they went out and found literally just some American people, not even actors, and said, "Do you want to do the voices for the English dubbing?"
Outside the studio,
it was just some people that were willing to do it that were in Japan that they could get into the studio. They didn't even go out and get actors. That could be like an urban myth, but I'm sure I read that somewhere. About Resident Evil, so that's legendarily terrible voice acting.
Well, to be fair, you just stole the one that I wanted to go for, because that was the first on my list.
Sorry.
I want to say any of the Final Fantasy games with voiceovers, whether they've been good or not.
Oh, what was that one in Final Fantasy 12 where you have to go around and go like, "Ha ha ha, I'm Captain Marsh," or whatever it was. There's one bit where you've got to pretend to be somebody else and your main character has to go and start spouting random phrases at NPCs, and it's just awful, like, so cringeworthy. Ugh.
I think it was Final Fantasy X was the first one with voiceovers, wasn't it? Am I right?
I don't know. I've only played 7 and 12.
No, he didn't, no.
Did it not in the cutscenes or something?
No, not even in the cutscenes.
Oh.
Hmm. Had singing in it, but it didn't have any voices.
Was 9 on the PlayStation 1, or was that on the PS2?
Nine was PS1. It was one of the more medieval style ones, a fantasy.
Yeah, an RPG of that size.
Had dagger in it.
Yeah.
What's just said Charn Hell? Bastard.
Touché!
very well put. You know what? I don't even know why I suggested this, because I'm struggling with anything but Resonance Arcade. There's a number that I'm finding online, though. Sorry?
Resident Evil, you meant to say. That's Resident Arcade.
This is just a long, continuous bad voiceover.
Our voice acting in this series has been atrocious, to be quite frank.
Who the fuck did they pick to voice me?
To be fair, I've played through the series again. There's been some pretty bad moments in the Metal Gear Solid franchise.
Well,
even though it's quite cartoony and enjoyable, some of the voice acting is so cheesy and terrible.
Some of the scripting's terrible in it, though.
Yeah.
I wouldn't necessarily say voice acting. I'd say the scripting is worse than anything.
I agree. It's a little bit of the case of people having to go at Hayden Christensen for the prequels, and it's like, yeah, but look at the lines he has to give. And like, no one can make them sound good.
To be fair, Liquid Snake, whoever plays him, is that what you're talking about?
Liquid Snake, yeah. He's actually a really well-known voice actor. I'm trying to forget his
name. Awful though in those games. Well,
he did the thing in the Turtles, and he did Canada in Akira and stuff like that.
Shall I read out some? Shall I read out some of the ones here? See if you guys have played them.
Can I just say that Deus Ex, some of the voices in that were decidedly dodgy.
That's on this list. That's the first one, in fact.
JC and Paul's voices were terrible.
They were, but I'd never really cared that much because everything else was so awesome. I forgave
them. It was a well-written game with bad voices as opposed to a badly written game with good voices, so it's the opposite of Metal Gear Solid.
Yeah. there's a game called Two Worlds that's getting quite a lot of mentions. I don't know if you've heard of that.
Two Worlds.
187 Ride or Die. Never heard of that. Far Cry 3. It's not that bad.
I thought the voice was
Who are they referring to in Far Cry 3?
Probably Jason, I would imagine.
Jason's not bad.
Not every character in the game is terrible, although when the voice of the protagonist, Jason, is one of the weaker voice actors, it makes it difficult to ignore. It's not that bad. Shut up.
I thought the whiny dick that he is.
Yeah, he's like an extreme sports, spiky-haired douche. Like it's the voice that fits the character. But no, anyway.
But you can't criticise a game where it's got Vass in it, because he's just brilliant. And I didn't realise the guy who plays Vass looks exactly like Vass.
Yeah, he's actually in Better Call Saul, that guy. The Breaking Bad spin-off. It's like somebody that Saul has dealings with in that.
Did you see...
And he plays it a lot more low-key, a lot less fast than...
Did you see the real footage promo videos that they did for Far Cry 3, where they actually had the actor playing Vass dressed up as Vass doing horrible things? Cool. It's on YouTube and stuff. They did a lot of little mini... videos of him basically broadcasting these tortured scenes and stuff like that from the island, and they're hilarious. He's brilliant.
Nice. Sonic Adventure.
Never played it. Yes, I actually did get that a while ago, and the voice acting is quite disgraceful. Just think of like, "Hey Tails," that kind of like voice acting. It's really that.
The House of the Dead 2. The House of the Dead, isn't it? Just House of the Dead.
The House of the Dead. I think it's just House of the Dead, yeah.
Maybe.
I don't know.
Devil May Cry.
Yes. Devil May Cry. So, like, ugh. Then again, that's badly written, though. Like, a lot of it is down to the script. It's a terribly written game. I'm sorry to any fans out there, but the story and the script in Devil May Cry is fucking shit. And you have to acknowledge that. Gameplay's really good fun. Story and stuff, wank. Just wank.
Mortal Kombat 4. I can't remember 4.
All the Mortal Kombat games. Get over here!
Yeah, get over here!
Just Cause 2. I've got it, but I haven't played it yet.
I don't know.
Don't know if the voice acting's Resident Evil.
I think there was a lot of... It's before voice acting was seen as an important thing. When you got like the early PlayStation games that had it, I mean, even something like Metal Gear Solid, for its time, had really great... like serious voice acting in it, whereas now you might look back at it and see it's really it's very cartoony voice acting. A lot of it, there's lots of very affected voices and over the top kind of almost like Saturday morning style delivery. But for its time, it seemed really good and like it was being done seriously, as opposed to like Resident Evil, which is just awful, like really awful. I don't know, it's a weird
Time
thing.
Time Crisis as well has got a few mentions.
I remember that's pretty bad. It's like an old arcade game. I think of those arcade games ever having voices in them. It's just lots of gunshots.
Well, it's usually the bits in between the game where he's going, "I have your daughter," or whatever. Whatever he has of yours.
Oh, God. Have you mentioned Daytona?
Nope.
Game over, yeah!
Oh, that's a really weird, yeah.
Yeah, the crazy singing in it. It's not really a voiceover, but it's still. But you must be aware of Game Over, yeah. The fact that it was used in the G.I. Joe videos as well.
No, I only know it from Game Over, yeah, podcast, and is that.
Right. I'm assuming that's from Daytona. It was Ridge Racer.
Daytona also had that like Daytona like theme song when it was doing the little demo reel at the arcades. That would be really fucking loud when you walk, because back when there were arcades with games in, which I'm sure there still are, but I haven't been in one for about 20 years. Yeah, all the arcades would shout at you to get your attention. Like, the demo reels would be so loud to try and get you to go and go over to the game. It just burned into my mind.
Well, yeah. I have exhausted myself, and I, to be fair, shouldn't really have chosen that because I have no idea.
That was quite. Got through a few,
That was quite a good laugh at subject, I think.
Someone, Butts just said GTA 5 characters. Some of them. I don't necessarily agree with that. Well, I thought they were
very good voices, yeah.
Oblivion had some poor side, you know, like side voice actors, I think. Imagine most of them were side voice.
I think the problem that Oblivion and Morrowind and Skyrim had was that the characters often didn't have a feel for the context in which they were going to be placed. I think it was written without the context being set, so the characters' voices are often woefully inadequate for the scene that they're doing.
Yeah, in general. Hello.
There was one character, a homeless guy in Oblivion, and I'm sure you had to speak to him as part of the Thieves Guild quest. When he would talk to you and be like, "Oh, arms for a beggar," and you talk to him and be like, "Yes, you must go over here," and you're like, "What the fuck?"
I remember
his voice just completely changed.
I'm not sure
if that was a mistake or it was because once you'd said that you were part of the Thieves Guild, he dropped his act or something, but it was really weird.
No, that happened a lot. Like, you get the same voice actor doing the wrong accent for the same character.
Yeah,
you get that a lot in Morrowind as well.
Well, no, I remember that particular one Sam was talking about. It was actually two completely different voices between when you're walking past him and he's just doing an ambient, like, arms for the poor or whatever, and then you speak to him and he's like this really posh dude. Like, really
Do you know what he sounded like? It sounded like Patrick Stewart doing the voice for the... Because he did the King.
Yeah.
But it sounded like him, like they got him to do an extra voice or something. The Emperor, sorry.
Patrick Stewart.
You'll accept him.
I can't take him seriously. I really
Sorry, Potato meant that the characters in Grand Theft Auto 5 are voiced by people who look just like them.
They do that quite a lot, though, these days. They do that quite a lot. I mean, I think, not Ellen Page, but the girl in Last of Us, I think she's...
That is Ellen Page, isn't it?
No.
No, it's not.
You think it is. She actually did Soul...
Something about Two Souls.
Two Souls, that's it.
Beyond Two Souls.
I haven't played that, but it does appeal to me. Is it out? It's out, isn't it?
It must be. Yeah, it's out. I've seen the playthrough of it, because I kind of wanted to see what it was like. It was kind of a comedy playthrough, like kind of taking the piss out of it.
Right.
It's okay. It's very sort of silly and melodramatic. Kind of an interesting gameplay mechanic where she has got essentially like a ghost that lives in her body that she can talk to, and it's kind of like a twin soul to her, and you can control the ghost thing and do weird shit with it. So she's got kind of like psychic powers, but it's another entity that she calls, I think she calls it Aiden.
Chris has just seen what I've seen.
What?
Two souls, one cup. Nice. Oh, right.
Tasteful.
Yes. Shall we move on then? Shall we move on to the news?
Yes.
And before we do, I just want to prove that I do have a neck, by the way. Because I know it's quite difficult to see with the old beard and the t-shirt being roughly the same colours.
There you go. Neck confirmed.
Neck confirmed.
Taking that one off the list.
Yes. I just noticed that I seem to be like a little head floating around. A little face floating around.
On a black mat.
On a black thing. Right, so something got announced today, the Project Blue Streak by Bosky Studios, which is Cliffy B's studio, have now released the name of their new FPS shooter, which is a 5v5 multiplayer PC free-to-play Unreal Engine 4 game called Lawbreakers. And the premise... Go on.
I was going to say, this is another Battleborn sort of game, isn't it?
It certainly seems to be that way. Now, the premise is that the moon has been experimented on, and the shattering has occurred. And this video that I'm showing is the release trailer, or the teaser trailer rather. There's no gameplay in it yet. but they're going to be releasing a gameplay trailer soon. But they were doing a live stream on Twitch today, and I just caught the end of it, and they were having loads of stream problems. God bless them. There were loads of audio issues, and the stream quality was going down every 5 seconds. But basically, after a certain amount of years or whatever, the world becomes... the world forgets about the shattering, but gangs start evolving, and then basically there are two factions. That's the premise of the multiplayer, is you've got the people who are the law and then the people who are the law breakers, and that's the premise of the game, the multiplayer. Now apparently there's a grappling hook in it, and you can grapple from place to place, you can shoot, you know, lots of different types of classes of people going on it. There's a teaser trailer which I will send this, so anybody who hasn't seen it can, I'll post you the GameSpot link into chat. It looks all right, but I just not feeling much different yet, you know. I'm not feeling much new in it.
It looks from that trailer, has he got a thing about the color gray where like he just wants all his games to be like super gray? Like it's just it has that same color palette as Gears of War. It's like, right, gray fest. Like, it just is a little grey and slightly brown colours.
Yeah. Well, there was a little bit of orange and blue in there as well, though, so...
A little bit.
And there was a light grey as well.
The light grey, that's the one.
The light grey. It's browns that he likes anyway, normally.
Anyway,
they were doing a live stream, and they were, you know, talking it up and everything and getting dead excited about it, and... I don't know. It sounds like something I'll keep my eye on, you know. But I don't know if I'm bothered about multiplayer FPS games these days.
I'm getting a little annoyed now that every big announcement is another class-based first-person shooter.
With a bit of progression, and this is free-to-play as well, remember, so that means that there's going to be...
So it fits the stereotype even more.
This means it's going to be a buy-your-upgrades, probably not moddable.
Do you think it will be pay-to-win, or do you think it'll be more pay-to-customize, like TF2?
Well... How else can they make some money? You know, if it's just pay to
customize.
TF2
made money.
Okay. Maybe. I don't know. I can't really speculate at this point, can we? Because we don't really know. Cliffy B's been under the influence, essentially, of large studios for a while, under the influence of Epic and publishers, etc. But he's now independent.
Yeah.
And he's got his own studio, and he's doing essentially what he says he wants to do.
It just so happens that what he wants to do is the same as what everyone else wants to do.
It sells, doesn't it? Modern Warfare set the path for everything, and that's what people want now. Tribes actually set the path originally, so screw you, Modern Warfare. But nobody cared about Tribes, that was a problem.
Team Fortress probably set the original.
The original Team Fortress, I suppose. Yeah, came before Tribes. Quake 1. But yeah.
Okay.
We'll see. It's going to be class-based. Apparently, at the moment, everyone in your team can all be the same class if you want, you know, type thing. They're not restricting it. But I don't know how it's going to work. I don't know how you're going to be able to work together to reach a goal or whatnot. They haven't released that much about it. I'll see what the gameplay trailers look like. They also did a teaser. Let me paste this link into chat.
Does this have any gameplay in it, by the way?
No, there's no gameplay yet. I think they were talking about, like, I think it was maybe the 6th of September or something for gameplay. I can't remember exactly what they said on the stream, but I've forgotten. You can watch the stream on Twitch, on /Lawbreakers, I believe. Oh, sorry. Had audio playing then, I didn't mean to play it. But yeah, another. It's apparently PC focused as well, so that's interesting.
It's a very console oriented series, yeah. But
what else has he done?
I think Cliffy B is certainly a PC stalwart, isn't he? Probably going back to his roots a bit.
What other games has he done before?
Unreal. He was responsible for the whole Unreal series.
Right. Oh, okay.
I did not know that as a fact. Sorry, I'm useless. Any other opinions about this? Anyone in chat got any? What Potato Power says, F2P games that are P2W don't last long. Is it going to be pay to win, though? That's the thing.
Well, I think what the point he's making is that if they do it that way, then it won't last long, which I agree with.
Yeah. I guess if someone who is behind Instrumental in franchises like Unreal Tournament and Gears of War, you'd hope that he would not sort of make that decision. If he's going independent, you'd think a little bit of artistic freedom would be there, so that not to make it a pay-to-win type scenario.
Yeah, I don't think it'll be pay-to-win, personally.
Pay-to-customise, I can see. Because yeah. People like to spend money on stupid hats. Fine, that's what they want to do.
Or pay for extra content, so you'll be able to buy new maps and stuff, and you'll only be able to play in those maps if you've paid for the map packs or whatever. It'll work like that. I don't think it'll work where you pay to get an advantage over your fellow players.
We shall give Cliffy B the benefit of the doubt until confirmed otherwise, I guess. Yeah. Because he's got a good reputation, hasn't he?
I watched quite an in-depth video of Battleborn recently. First time I'd actually watched some proper gameplay of it. And it looks great fun. It looks like Borderlands 2, but with like team-based multiplayer. It's got the same kind of feel to it and the same graphical finesse to it.
Which game, sorry?
Battleborn, the new Gearbox title.
Yeah.
Which is also a class-based first-person shooter.
When is that slated for release, or is it not?
Next year, I believe.
Just sometime next year.
Yeah, I don't know if there's a solid release date yet, but there's a really slick video with some good story behind it and good voiceovers showing some of the characters off. Explains like kind of similar to that actually. The universe is near the end of its life, and it's being accelerated, and there's one star left, and it's got some plants around it. And you basically all the species from around the universe have congregated on one planet to beat the shit out of each other. It's nicely done, actually. The voiceover is really nicely done, but you kind of expect that from Gearbox now. Some nicely done storyline.
Cool.
As for this, I can't really comment without seeing it, but it looked. My first reaction is, oh no, not another class-based FPS.
Yeah,
but we'll see.
We'll see, and I'm sure we'll be able to get some. You know, we'll start seeing some gameplay content, etc. Okay, so one game that's coming up that I found out about a few weeks back. It's been around for a while. It might even have been a Kickstarter game. It's called Satellite Rain. Now, have you heard of this before, Lou, or
yes.
Have you just heard about it when I've?
No, I heard about this because I've been spending the last 15 years looking for Syndicate Wars remakes.
So, yeah, this is a Syndicate-influenced game that very much reminds me of the modern Shadowrun game as well. It's got that kind of...
same sort of look, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's got that isometric
neon,
kind of...
look.
Yeah, and I'm quite looking forward to this.
It looks cool. I have to say, I watched the trailer earlier.
Yeah,
I've not watched this yet.
There's a trailer, but this is this is some gameplay that's on YouTube. But, I mean, I haven't watched any much gameplay, to be fair, but I like isometric kind of stealth-em-up cyberpunk-type games anyway. I mean, I absolutely loved Shadowrun, and I enjoyed Syndicate when it was around back in the day. I didn't play it as much as Lou did, I don't believe.
Steve and I completed the game with both factions, and it was a joy. Every mission was a different puzzle with a completely different strategy to it, and most of the joy was in, like, continually restarting the missions and trying to nail the strategy really well. And so if this game's got that sort of stuff, then I'm looking forward to it.
Unfortunately, there's not much going on in this particular video.
No, he's just zooming in on some water.
Yeah, maybe it'll skip to something happening eventually, but the game has a very, very nice art style to it. It looks pretty cool. From the trailer that I watched earlier, it looked pretty cool.
See, I've got Syndicate Wars, but I never played the original Syndicate.
I've only played Syndicate Wars, I haven't played Syndicate. I've heard that Syndicate's better than Syndicate Wars, but I've not really tested that theory. But we loved Syndicate Wars. It was a very good co-op experience. So if this does co-op as well, that'd be great. It looks a lot more sedentary than Syndicate Wars. Syndicate Wars was quite balls of the wall, just running in and blowing shit up, but this looks like there's a bit of stealth involved.
I don't know that much about it. I just heard Syndicate, and I knew you might be interested in it. And I think it's coming. It's coming out on the 28th of August.
Oh,
2 days.
So 2 days.
Yeah, it's really close. To
I think the trailer's on satelliterain.com, which I will paste into chat.
Another Rain.
Regan.
Yeah, we need to read a game called Titan Rain, don't we?
Titan Rain, yeah.
Rain of the Titans. That's the one.
Yeah, so I'm. I said it doesn't particularly look much, look very interesting to watch, but I have a feeling that it'd be right up my street in terms of the immersion and just, I don't know. I like these kind of games. I like I like running around hacking things and.
Might be worth a squirt as a co-op stream, maybe, or a recording.
If it's co-op, I'd definitely be up for it.
I'm pretty sure it is co-op. But co-op's a big selling point of that genre.
Well, it looks, you know, very like cyberpunky, atmospheric. We didn't really see much there, but hopefully, the original games are quite well known for being quite tactical, weren't they?
Yeah.
On to the important news now. As I mentioned earlier on today, Metal Gear Solid 5 is out on Tuesday. It's coming out on PC, PlayStation 4, and I think it was Xbox One, I think, as well, maybe.
They'll be all on the same day.
All at the same time as well, and we were thinking we were going to have to wait 2 weeks for the PC release. However, it's not available for preload on Steam. Now, this doesn't sound like a big thing to you console gamers, but to us PC gamers, if we want a game on release day and we don't have a physical copy of it, i.e. we download it on Steam, especially with big games like this, 70 gigs or whatever it's going to be, is going to take us a long time to download, especially when our download gets throttled by all the other people downloading the game at the same bloody time. Now, I don't know why they've not done this. It's probably they're a bit lazy and they can't be asked to protect it, you know, content protect it.
I reckon it's not finished yet.
That could also... Well, no, what they normally do, though, is they'll release most of the game, i.e. most of the assets, they'll get downloaded, and then they'll release the final kind of, here you go, this is the XE, this is the working part of the game, you know?
Yeah. But, that's what they did with Half-Life 2. It was a really weird stage release.
But yeah,
it could be just the fact that like they've not really done a release like this for a Metal Gear game before, and they're just shit at it. Because they haven't done it before, so they've not planned it properly.
I think I don't know. I mean, it doesn't bother me because I'm on holiday anyway, and I'm not going to be able to download it until everyone else has probably bloody completed it. Mind you, I think that's going to be a mean feat because it's going to be a huge game.
I think with all the side ops, I think they've already talked about it having plus 100 hours gameplay, so that ain't happening.
I can't wait. I've played like 90 odd hours of Witcher, for fuck's sake. I'm gonna be consumed. This is the stealth ops game that I've wanted my entire life. I can't wait for it. I can't wait for. I haven't even seen that much of the. I've been avoiding all of the spoilers and trailers and everything. But the maybe
there's five, a lot in it, mate.
Maybe 5 minutes of what I have seen. I've already seen more content than I know what to do with. I can't wait to full-ton everything. Everything is going to get full-toned to Mother Base. And I'm just going to have... Apparently every soldier as well has their own unique face as well and their own unique... I know that isn't that difficult to do these days, but it's, again, nice that we don't have general soldiers all over the place.
That's a nice thing. I think they... if it's like the way to do it in Peace Walker, they'll all have their own stats and things and you slot them into it. Roles, and then you can send them out on side missions, hopefully train them up and get your own little private army
as long
that's
as it's not like Assassin's Creed contracts where you just basically select a country and then send off six assassins for 20 minutes.
In Peace Walker you could do a lot of side ops as your recruits, so right. If there was a side op for like, oh, do like this, you know, get to this point without being spotted and pick up microfilm or whatever, like a side quest, you could do them as not Snake. You could pick a recruit who you wanted to level up a bit and do that as them, which is great because it meant you actually get to, those are the best way to level them up. There were also ones where you could send them off to do X mission, they come back in 5 minutes and then they get X reward when they do it, which is fine. That's like, you could, there was quite a lot of depth in the Peace Walker one, and it looks like this one's going to be even more, so there's going to be a lot of balls in the air. For Snake to handle.
My balls are well gonna be in the pit, waiting for it.
Yeah, right in it.
Metal Gear Solid commentary book by writers of Borderlands 2. Now I know Lou put this in.
Yes. So the Birch siblings, Anthony and I'm forgetting the name, the girl who played Tiny Tina in Borderlands, have written a book.
Yeah.
about Metal Gear Solid.
Okay.
It sounds very interesting. The link that I put in there is a review of the book.
Excuse me.
And they've just kind of... It's worth a read. The review is worth a read, and it makes it seem like the book would be worth a read. I don't know if either of you guys have read this kind of
synopsis. I read the review.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what do you think?
Do you know what it made me think of? It made me think of our own personal commentary that we did on the game and we played through it, because basically, to sum it up, it says these are people that played the game when they were teenagers or kids, loved it, it had a massive effect on them, like it did with Chris and myself. Then they've gone back to it and critiqued it as adults with perspective of, you know, being more mature themselves and also having played a lot more games and games having moved on. So they talk about all the daft stuff. The fact that basically the Metal Gear Solid does have this, like, the ridiculous, crazy stuff and the sort of serious stuff is always kind of like this throughout the series. It's always a serious message, but then there's always, like, somebody's knickers to look at. Do you know what I mean? There's always, like, damn shit.
Naked
going, going right next to, like, quite serious, you know.
There's a lot of
stuff to do with war.
Allegory in there as well, and a lot of kind of... political commentary and also not just political, social as well, but the other one. Brain stopped. Shut up, Chris.
I don't know.
There's a lot
of... Birch, by the way.
All right.
There you go. So it sounds like they've sort of, they've gone and given the game its dues where it deserves them, but also ripped it apart where it has places to be ripped apart. Which is, to my mind, is kind of like what we did on our playthrough. We said the bits that were good and we said the bits that were shit. And I don't think we were precious about it.
No, I mean, don't get me wrong, I still enjoyed the playthroughs. It did make me realise how utterly terrible I am at stealth games, and it made me realise how I do rely, and I seem to enjoy stealth games more when I reload things, you know, when I do it as I want to do it.
Scum.
But I don't... The thing is, I don't save scum every game. It's only certain games that I do that with. Like Dishonored.
Games with save ability.
No. Dishonored, I've been playing the, whatever it's called, the DLC through recently.
Yeah.
And didn't save any of that. If someone saw me, and to be fair, rarely did, I just dealt with it in whatever way I could. You know, usually ran off and hid before, so I didn't have to kill them.
Yeah.
But I mean, I managed to do it with only one kill, I think, all the way through the DLC, which was pretty good going for not reloading, unless I died. You know, if I died, you have to reload anyway, don't you? So,
yeah.
But uh-huh. I also wait, see, I said this to Steve the other week, and I said that I also F5 every 5 seconds. Is that save scumming?
It only saves scumming if you reload.
Right, manually reload if you do something that you didn't
want
to do.
Yeah, you kind of half save scumming there. You complete the circle of save scummery by reloading as soon as you die, because then you're not being punished for dying.
Mm.
By saving constantly, as soon as you load the game for making a mistake, that's save scumming, because you're not getting any adequate punishment for your loss. You're reloading it to 5 seconds before you died.
Yeah, but
if a game gives you that,
my time is precious.
Anyway, that's the ethics of save scumming is different.
We should have a whole episode on it.
It sounds like it might be a semi-interesting read for myself, because I've got a feeling they might not have much more insight than I've already had myself over the years. Not to sound arrogant, but there's a lot of things they probably talk about that I've already read up on or done, because I'm a big fucking Metal Gear geek. So it might be an interesting retrospective. I'm not sure. It's the kind of book that I'd kind of almost like to get from the library and read rather than go out and buy and read, because it might be interesting, but I might not want to pay money for it, if that makes sense.
What I will say is that I've not read this book, and I'm not a massive fan of Metal Gear Solid, but I am a massive fan of Anthony Birch and Ashley Birch's style of delivery of things. Anthony is a really good writer, and Ashley is she's very good at making things funny in a kind of profound way. So I think it's not so much the things that they find interesting or the things that they expose from their own experience of it, but the way that they do it is probably going to be the most entertaining part of that book. So you probably won't be going into it expecting to learn much, but I think their take on it will probably be quite entertaining.
Yeah, possibly. I don't really play the Borderlands games, so I don't really have much to say to them as writers.
Borderlands 2 is fantastic.
Yeah.
The writing in that game is excellent.
So, Ready Player One movie announced for a 2017 release.
Now, Steve lent me the book and I've not started reading it yet. It's Spielberg's doing the movie though, isn't he?
What is this? That's just words to me. What?
It's kind of like Steve described it to me as Harry Potter, but set in games rather than magic.
So a kid will get a letter, or not a letter, get an email saying, you're actually a gamer, Harry. And then he'll get on a, he'll get on a magnetic hypertrain and go into the game world.
It's probably not that verbatim.
He won't get a wand. He'll get a quick scope sniper rifle, and he'll be like Leak Gamer 77XXX blazing 420. No, I get what you mean.
A virtual reality universe called.
Yeah. I get the idea, and he'll be like. Some sort of it's another chosen one story then possibly
yeah. I've not read the book yet, but Steve recommended it. Mythalos said he didn't think it was a great book. He said it was massively overhyped.
Okay,
so
thank you very much for the follow, Riotous, by the way. Go on.
I was only going to say that with Spielberg on board, you know that it'll at the very least be an engaging experience to watch. Like, he doesn't make films that are just unwatchable. So it kind of gives me a little bit of hope, but there's so little detail, it's so thin on the ground yet that I reserve any judgment until I see anything. But games to movies, even if it's a movie about games as a thing, I've got a very, very dodgy track record. Wreck-It Ralph's the only one that's ever done it in a quite a positive way. Most of them have been quite shit. So if Spielberg can turn that around... True, indie game, the movie, but that's a documentary rather than a movie with a narrative, a beginning, a middle, and an end, and a hero and a villain and a whatever. It's a documentary, it's like a different thing. We'll see.
My manager at work has been trying to get me to watch King of Kong as well, which is supposed to be hilarious, which is about a professional Donkey Kong gamer and his rival.
I've heard of that. Someone mentioned it a while back.
It's very, very strange, almost a mockumentary. It probably is a mockumentary, I think, but it's very surreal.
Yeah, I've heard of that one. We'll see. I don't really know if he's going to go the whole mocap route like he did in that Tintin film, which I quite enjoyed.
I haven't seen that yet.
It was quite daft, but it was enjoyable to watch. It's like if you like sort of action stuff and shit exploding, it's quite good.
I think Beowulf put me off that style of movie.
Yeah, it can work, I think. It's a slightly uncanny... Still slightly the uncanny valley with it a little bit. But I don't know if he's going to do that, because if you're doing a computer game world, it would make sense for it to be computer animated if you're going to go into a computer game world. It could be a case of, like, the real... You know, our world is live action, and then when he gets in the computer world, it's, like, computer animated.
Just like Tron, basically.
Yeah, well... I don't know what the story's about. I'm just totally like,
yeah,
making my own assumptions about what the story could be like. We'll see. Can Spielberg do it? He's capable. Don't know if he will. He's getting a bit old now.
You lost me there. You might have figured that out by my silence. I'm not sure what any of that is about.
Okay. Well, this next one's probably pretty easy for you to work out, Chris.
Yeah, but before I show it, have you got anything to say about it? Because it's a little bit gratuitous, isn't it?
It's gratuitous. I think it's wonderful. I think any of the people who developed the game sat and watched this unfolding would be so proud of the fact that these systems work the way they do. Have you watched this, Sam? I can see by the smile.
Yeah,
I've
watched it. To be fair, the whole 5 minutes of it got a little bit like, all right, but it's kind of fun for a bit. I think 5 minutes.
I was laughing more as it went on. When it started to get ridiculous and silly, and there was just explosions everywhere, and people running around, and paramedics getting ran over.
He just kicked someone. He was on fire on the floor, so he kicked him, caught fire.
That is the best bit of the whole video. When he kicks the guy on fire and then sets on fire. it's quite,
I don't know, it's such a beautiful example of the emergent nature of the game.
It's I suppose it's, I'm presuming this is in single player.
Yes, it is, yeah.
Yeah. Well, if it was in multiplayer...
If it was in multiplayer, there'd be some twat flying around in a Huey shooting rockets at him.
Yeah. So this is just... This is basically a five-minute explosion pile-up.
It's a five-minute cause and effect. I can't remember where I found it. I think it was on Facebook or something. Someone posted. But it's just the causality of it all. You can just see it constantly unfolding.
Well,
I love that it just keeps going.
You've got to say something about the AI, though. You've got to say, come on, guys. There's a big fucking explosion going on in front of you. Don't drive into it.
For example...
Yeah, but you've been spawned before the ambulance...
Sorry, what?
Before the ambulance turned up, a yellow car drove away from the explosions towards the player and then went back into the explosions again. That's some bad AI. And they also do that thing where they drive onto the explosions and they, rather than reversing and driving away, they try, like there, they try and go round it. Like, that's what you do. If I saw an explosion on a motorway, I'd just be like, I'll go round it.
Look at this guy.
If you think from an AI point of view, the AI wants to get down the road. The AI wants to get past any obstacle. So what the AI does is try and find a way around the obstacle. It doesn't really care that much if the obstacle's exploding and on fire.
Now,
it still has to get around it.
I don't care.
Maybe it should.
I don't particularly care how bad the GTA Online aspect of GTA is, but it is still a very good, I mean, not just good, it's an amazing achievement at GTA.
It is,
GTA in general. I mean, and there's, I mean, to be fair, not that much wrong with the game either, the single player. I should really play through the single player on PC again.
It's a fantastic game. It's almost.
To be fair, the one thing about the single player that got me was I would have liked a more definitive villain that showed up earlier that you knew who it was. Not, I didn't really feel like I was invested in the end
was
of getting
guy
the bad
dress?
Guys. I don't know.
Probably.
It looked like some dude I've seen on TV recently.
That is probably my only criticism, though, is that the bad guys at the end of the game, I wasn't that invested in them at all, whereas in the other games, the bad guy was set up very early. Even if it wasn't someone you knew as a bad guy, you'd met them and got them to know them as a character, whereas a lot of the bad guys in that were introduced like 40 hours into the game. So that was a bit of a... just in terms of the ending, it wasn't quite as satisfying as the other GTA endings that felt like you'd capped off a big adventure, you know?
I have to agree with that, actually. Now I'm thinking about it, I couldn't even remember who the antagonist was in the game.
It wasn't that important. Well, potentially Trevor, if you look at it in that way, but because you had what was it? It was your partner lady in the first one, who was like in Grand Theft Auto 3, sorry. The woman that you start out with, she leaves you at the bank robbery and she's the bad guy. You've got the guy who sent you to Vice City in Vice City, you hear on the phone and then comes and you kill him, and Lance Vance. And in San Andreas, it was Tenpenny, who's a dick to you from the first second of the game, and you know he's the bad guy. So they kind of like set up their bad guys better in the early installments. Whereas in this one, I think they got so carried away with the world that they forgot to really like tie a sort of villain narrative into it properly. I don't know. Still a fucking great game. I'm kind of nitpicking there, to be honest, because I enjoyed it. I enjoyed all like 70 hours of it that I played. So can't really slag it off.
I love that this explosion is still going on. Things are still exploding. There's still paramedics turning up. Just a bad fuel to the fire.
Oh, the traffic's finally stopped, though. Oh, no, it hasn't. No, it hasn't.
You'll see the occasional car come driving in.
They're waiting. Anyway, let's move on. Let us move on.
Yeah.
Resident Evil 2 remake announced. Now, is this a remake of the game, I'm presuming?
Yeah, this is a remake of the game. Yeah, I put this one in as well. So, after the success of the remake of the first one, they're going for another one. They're going for two, which is apparently a lot of people's favourite version.
It is probably my favourite Resident Evil. Now, as much as I've said I want them to do this, here's the issue, and it's the same issue that you guys probably have with Final Fantasy VII. The team that worked on Resident Evil and the Resident Evil remake, which don't forget came out on the GameCube several years ago, and Shinji Ikami, the guy behind Resident Evil, was still made the remake. He's not with Capcom anymore. So the people that are doing the Resident Evil 2 remake is going to be a different team. So if they go, let's just do the Resident Evil 1 remake style with Resident Evil 2, then I'm in. I'm totally in. If they don't, and they do it like they try and make it into Resident Evil 5, but with the 2 like story, then I'm out. So hopefully they're going to do it properly.
I'm not a massive fan of the Resident Evil series, but I have played 1 and 2, and 2 is my favourite out of them. Oh, no, I played 3 as well, which is Nemesis, isn't it? Every time we talk about it, I say the same bloody thing. It's 3 Nemesis. Is it the same as Nemesis?
Yeah, yeah. Well, plus, because there's a bit of crossover between 2 and 3, because you go to the police station in 2 and 3, but it's like slightly different. So there's a bit of crossover with those two games as well.
Right, so does which one's the one that Nemesis first like bashes through the wall?
When
you're walking down a corridor,
that's in Resident Evil 2.
Right, okay.
It's not called the Nemesis, but it's a big bloke in a trench coat who's like, comes through the wall and like attacks you. That was Resident Evil 2. Yeah, because you had the different scenarios. If you played through Leon's A scenario, you then got to play through Claire's B scenario. Following that, it was quite a cool thing at the time, actually, because you got to see the two stories overlap, as opposed to Resident Evil 1, where you just pick a character and that's just you get that character's story, or you pick the other character and get the other character's story. Yeah, Resident Evil 2 was the best. I think it's really atmospheric. I love the design of the police station, which is the most impractical police station ever, but it's still a cool like location to go to. Yeah, just really enjoyed it. Love the guns, like the zombies are much better. It's just awesome. All right,
don't go down a corridor. Just don't go down a corridor that's got a dead end and then go back and not expect zombies to be there.
Yeah.
And I remember this. I mean, I think this is the remake, though, isn't it? It's not the original graphics.
This isn't a remake. Yeah, this is like somebody's mod remake. This isn't, because the remake hasn't even been made yet. Somebody's done their own fan-made sort of thing.
Oh, well I'm sorry for showing that, then.
This might be a taste of what it's like. This is literally step for step the exact same thing, whereas the Resident Evil remake, as in the one that recently came out and was so successful, had that game in there, but it also added a lot of different mechanics. It changed the mansion around enough, added extra areas and things, extra things to do. So it was a remake, but it was also an upgrade. And now this is obviously just somebody's gone, right, I want to take everything from the original Resident Evil 2 and make it look better. It's the same game, essentially. So, I don't know. It's a bit like the Final Fantasy VII thing. It's like, if they can do it right, yes, brilliant. If they don't, fuck off.
Yeah.
Basically, do it right or get out of my face. That's my attitude towards it. So, we'll see. I potentially could be super, super excited about it, but I'm going to wait until I see a bit of gameplay footage, I think. That's my two cents on that.
Next. So, Daggerfall.
Yeah, there's an unofficial Daggerfall remake. Now, I don't know if I mentioned it on the stream, but last time we talked about this thing called Daggerfall Unity, which is basically a set of tools that you can whack into Unity and you can load the Daggerfall files. And Daggerfall was the game before Morrowind, by the way. And you can kind of basically make your own version of Daggerfall. Now, what the guy who made that has decided to announce is that he's going to treat the player to an actual Daggerfall remake using these tools that he's developed. So rather than just create these tools for other developers, you'll be able to download an updated Daggerfall engine and play Daggerfall on a modern machine. And Daggerfall is a great game. It's a really, really good game.
Is it one of the first like 3D RPG type games of its kind?
I don't think it's 3D. Not fully 3D.
It is 3D.
Is it not?
Yeah, it is fully 3D. Yeah. Oh,
okay.
It is fully 3D. You can climb walls and climb on top of houses and stuff like that. Yes, it's there's a lot of 3D RPGs in the style of the old Ultima Underworld and stuff like that, which is what Doom was inspired by. But it was one of the first very open world games like that. The world is huge in this. It's like tens of thousands of square kilometers of world. Most of it is wasteland. There is fast travel.
There is fast travel.
You need fast travel in this. You can't even walk to the next town. It's that big. But I think it's going to be a nice treat actually, because there's been a few false starts with Daggerfall remakes, and this one is sufficiently far now that if you whack it into Unity and get it set up, you've actually got pretty much a playable game.
And is that legally okay for them to do that?
It's legally okay because he's not releasing the files, unlike PowerSlave EX that I mentioned earlier, where he actually released all of the files that he ripped off the PlayStation CD. This doesn't come with any of the assets. Basically, this is an engine. You whack your copy of Daggerfall, which you can download for free from Bethesda themselves, and you've got Daggerfall to play. So it's legally completely above ground.
So
PowerSlave EX isn't.
So, say that again. You what? You download Daggerfall from Bethesda?
Download Daggerfall from Bethesda. It's free. Freeware. They've put it on their site.
Yeah, yeah.
And then this is just the engine that runs all of the assets that come with the game.
Right, so the game doesn't run from Bethesda at the moment.
It does, but I think you need DOSBox for it, and it's not great.
No.
It was a game that was very tied to CPU speed. Jumping and climbing especially was really problematic, depending on your CPU speed. But all of that will be fixed in this, obviously, because it's written for a modern architecture.
Are you up for that then? Are you up for giving Daggerfall a go? Is it a 150-hour game like all the others?
It's I played it before using DOSBox, and I played it for about 15 hours and really enjoyed it. Although the missions and the quests and the locations are nowhere near as detailed as Skyrim or Morrowind or Oblivion, it's still a really enjoyable game. And it's a very big game, and I think the fact that he's releasing it with all the tools to expand upon it means that people could make it into a really interesting game beyond the scope of the original. And you see screenshots and stuff that other people have done. They've made very realistic terrains and weather and stuff like that. So it's very promising.
I probably won't bother. Got to be honest with you. I mean, I'd rather just continue to explore Skyrim or Oblivion or even Morrowind, to be fair.
Fair enough.
Because, you know, at least they're...
It's a much more accessible game, this, though. You can get into it really quickly. Whereas Oblivion's Skyrim.
Do you start off in prison?
You start off in a dungeon called Privateer's Hold, a very simple dungeon that you can get out of in a minute. Just run straight to the exit.
You still start off there. It's like a tradition you have to start off.
It is a tradition, yeah. You start off as an unnamed prisoner, and you get released by the Emperor for some unknown reason. That's the Elder Scrolls way. Anyway, yeah, that's one to watch out for if you're a fan of RPGs.
ZX Spectrum
Vega.
Vega, available from the 24th of August, so that's already available.
It's already available. It's just a little handheld Spectrum with 1,000 games built into it.
All right.
That you plug into your TV. That's it, basically, yeah.
Okay, Final Fantasy VII on iOS.
Yep, if you've got iOS 8 or above and an iPhone 5S or an iPad 3, you can play it. I don't. I've got a 4S, so I can't play it. So fuck you, Square, for... putting a game from 1996 and making it so I can't play it with my phone from 2 years ago.
Yeah. What a pack of cunts.
Not happy at all. Because I really want that game as a handheld.
Get a new iPhone then, dickhead.
Fuck you. Pay £500 for a new iPhone.
Yeah.
Get it on contracts. You don't have to pay for it then, do you?
No, it doesn't work, does it? It's free.
Fallout New Vegas unofficial Monopoly board.
Someone on Reddit has made a Monopoly board featuring the locations from Fallout New Vegas. Not having played it much myself, I don't know much about New Vegas.
I haven't played it at all.
Yeah, I preferred Fallout 3.
I didn't play it enough to give it time, and some when I started playing it originally, I got distracted with something else came out roughly around the same time, and I just didn't play enough of it. And it's like it's now it's sat there in my inbox, it's sat there in my Steam library, tempting me every time that I look for new games. I look at that and go, don't really want to play another 200 hour game, you know, that's old now. That I don't know. I love Fallout 3, but am I going to love Fallout New Vegas?
I get the feeling that people who like Vegas didn't play much of 3.
Yeah.
Because it's essentially the same thing.
Well, that's what I felt when I was playing it, but I didn't give it enough time.
Yeah, it felt like a slightly less polished version of Fallout 3. The locations were less impressive.
That's why I didn't bother with it, because all the stuff I saw from it was like, it's just a Fallout 3 expansion. We just got look, we'll just do the same game in a desert. As opposed to Washington AR.
Yeah,
I just didn't think there was enough different for me. Yeah, it just didn't look like there was enough in it for me to bother spending, you know, 40 quid on it when it came out. I just wasn't interested. And now it's old, and there's a new Fallout on the way, and I've played other games since then. It just doesn't hold any appeal for me. I'm sure the people that are into it found its own charm and whatnot, but yeah, I've never been bothered for New Vegas.
Okay.
Unfortunate.
Z Exemplar, an authentic Speccy R-type homage on Steam Greenlight.
Pronounced properly, Z Exemplar, as in ZX.
Whatever.
You Philistine. Now, back in one of the early shows, I mentioned the R-type on Sinclair Spectrum was one of our favourite games. And this is basically an homage to R-type. It's very similar, very, very similar, to the point where you could watch this and you'd think it was R-type. But he's done it in a very authentic Sinclair Spectrum look and feel.
Mm. Yeah, with all the backgrounds.
And I really like it, yeah.
And the sprites and things like that.
Yeah, and the jerkiness of the motion and stuff. Although he has actually put a feature so that you can have smooth motion as well if you prefer. But I love the look of this. And it's got procedurally generated levels as well. Which is another cool thing. It's not just like 10 levels. It's like, depending on the planet you go to next and how hostile it is, the level might be a different length and it'll be differently randomly generated, scaled up bosses and stuff. So, looks really interesting, this. I'd say get on that Steam community page and get it greenlit because I want to play this game. Please. Thank you. There you go. There's a link.
Yeah.
Go and do it.
It does look quite cool, actually. Yeah, I mean, those old games are quite good fun, those kind of.
Right, who's Derek Smart and why are you so annoyed about him?
Derek fucking Smart. Now, do you not read Something Awful back when there was a big feud with Derek Smart over his AD 3000 shite?
I obviously know of Something Awful, but I never really read it or followed it. I wasn't that bothered.
Derek
I like
Smart
Cranky
is,
Steve, that was about it.
Yeah, Derek Smart is an indie game developer who's been around since the beginning of time, and his forte is not making games. His games are shit. But what he's very good at is arguing with people on the internet. That is his calling. And now he's trying to sue Cloud Imperium Games, who are making Star Citizen, by saying that they're basically not delivering, or he wants proof that they're going to deliver the thing that they're doing. He wants to see what they're doing with the funds that they've got. Otherwise, he's going to sue them. And this call kicked off because he was a $250 backer for Star Citizen, and then Chris Roberts saw that he was a backer and kicked him off and gave him his money back. So he's taken umbrage to the fact that he's been kicked off the Kickstarter because he was clearly just on there to promote his own shit.
Yeah, yeah.
And cause trouble. So yeah, Derek Smart is one of the internet's oldest trolls, and he's doing what he does best here. And the big problem is, and the reason this is kicked off, is because Cloud Imperium will have to fight this lawsuit with funding money. So backers' money will go towards this lawsuit and defending against it rather than the game. Mm. Yet Derek Smart is saying he's doing this for the community. So it's a very interesting problem that we've got here. And Derek Smart seems to have really found something big to stick his nose in this time.
Yeah.
Slightly wanky behaviour, but I don't know the ins and outs of it, but it sounds a bit.
It's worth looking up something awful Derek Smart stuff, because you'll find lots about him from the past.
So, today we have a potentially, this is the last news article for the day, we're only 5 minutes late today, and we have a potentially life-changing thing that's happened. YouTube Gaming has now went live. We are not streaming on YouTube Gaming because I only found out about it 5 minutes ago, but we probably will start streaming to that as well as everything
else. We'll give it another go since the last time we tried it, was shit.
It wasn't live. It was quite difficult to set up a streaming set up events and book them in and come online at exactly the right time. And even then, it didn't bloody work, and it was horrible. Yeah. But
I think this does things different. I think this is
this
much
be just
simpler.
Be an RSTP server or whatever it is, like Twitch and Hitbox and everything else. And I'll be able to plug it into our Restream channel and just stream to it directly, which will suit me. It just means I have to have another bloody 4K monitor to monitor all the YouTube shit that we get coming in. But interesting. There's not just streaming though. I believe there's a lot of other gaming focused stuff going on with YouTube at the moment.
Yeah, they're categorizing all of the gaming content because they've got a shitload of gaming content. They just categorize it so you can find it easier.
Right.
So it's not so much about the streaming. It's also about the reclassification of their gaming content into a dedicated gaming channel.
Right.
YouTube's biggest, most successful person is a Let's Player.
Yeah, it is.
So it's a huge part of their business, isn't it? You know, a huge part of everything that goes on there is people watching people play games or stuff to do with games.
I mean, there's a hell of a lot of stuff that goes on with YouTube. But yeah, you're right. I think the vast majority of people that use it are for gaming related things.
I find this quite strange because I remember it being a big niche to watch gaming content online or to watch videos, like to watch speedruns or to watch machinima or things like that, and now it's grown to be one of the biggest things on the internet is watching people play games or watching, you know, stories unfolding games or whatever. I never would have called that for it to be that popular.
South Park started taking the piss out of it a few last season or earlier on in this season that they're in a break at the moment, and it made me, I mean, that was at the time when I was doing a lot of streaming myself, and I say that while streaming, but you know what I mean? I was doing a lot more like gaming and game dev streaming as well, and there seems to be all these new content places that are popping up. There's a one that I found out about the other day called Live Coding or something to that effect, and it's developers, it's for specifically for developers, and it suited me down to the ground instead of Twitch, because Twitch isn't particularly great for coding, for developing stuff, but it's interesting that all this is happening. It does seem to be the future. Even celebrity. Well, look at what happened today with Cliffy B's thing. They didn't go to a media outlet. I know they got a journalist on to interview them, but they didn't go to a media outlet. They did it directly from their office. You know, is this maybe the death of media, like of traditional media?
We can only hope.
I hope so, because at least things will be a bit more honest. There might be a bit more chaos. But it'll be a bit less. Directed for a particular agenda. Anyway,
I don't think you're going to lose media, but what you are going to get is the rise of PR over traditional media. So, by them doing that, they're basically opening the channels for PR for the media outlets to report on the release that they've done, rather than through normal advertising means. So. It might be a shift, but it won't be the death of media.
No. I don't think that the media will die, because obviously the TV is always still going to be, it's right there, isn't it? It's right in front of people, unless public access becomes the main, you know, the main draw on television, which is very unlikely, I think. Then, I just don't know. This is a different, it's a different form, isn't it? I mean, live streaming directly from a company is becoming a lot more popular now, not just streams like this, not just gamers, you know, individual gamers doing streams, not just the Twitch partners that have just been streaming for the last 2 or 3 years that have got 90 million followers. I'm talking about directly from businesses that would normally go to advertising company or a journalist or some kind of media company, you know, to promote their material. It seems to be coming directly from them now. It seems to be more common. That's what I'm saying.
Well, you say directly from them, but actually the media company now is YouTube or Twitch, isn't it? They're the ones with the advertising revenue.
Well, it depends, I think. Yeah, you're right.
It was just a bit of slight like paradigm shift. It's translated over to just a different media provider.
So essentially, then there's going to be a monopoly then in that case on it, because we've got Twitch. What is Twitch owned by?
Google? Amazon. It's owned by Amazon.
I know they got bought out recently. I couldn't remember who now.
Did Google wanted to buy them for a while, but then Amazon bought them.
I mean, I'm glad Google didn't, I'll be honest, because Google literally... I mean, as much as I like Google, they own everything now, don't they?
Yeah, but the Google have just done the next best thing, which is to make gaming, YouTube gaming, which will inevitably surpass Twitch.
Yeah, it will do, I imagine. But it's interesting. It's interesting where things are going, isn't it?
It is.
Yes.
I've got no problem with Google monopolizing things.
No, neither do I, really. I mean, they seem to do a fairly decent job of it. I just hope that there's no... Occasionally a little scandal appears, doesn't it, with Google? But I'm hoping there's no major scandals and no major kind of security breaches and leaks.
Mythalos pointed out that I mean Alphabet, and I do mean Alphabet, I'm sorry.
In what
because
respect?
Because the company that owns Google is called Alphabet.
Oh, yeah, they are now, yeah, as of a couple of weeks ago,
it was
wasn't
very
it?
Very recently, yeah.
What were they used to be called?
Google.
The company that owns the Google group of companies now has split off and become its own company called Alphabet.
Okay.
So Google is now a brand of Alphabet, whereas before Google was the thing that owned everything.
Okay.
Doesn't particularly affect us at the moment, but there'll be a reason for it. It'll be either tax incentives or... actually, we talked about this, didn't we, a few weeks ago. They're saying it's nothing to do with tax saving money, but it's to make their brand stronger or something to that effect anyway.
Yeah, it's so they don't have to call everything Google, I think, is the purpose of it.
Maybe. So, if you look at all of the products that are available in the UK, like I'm talking about cosmetic products, food products, they're all owned by four major parent companies.
Unilever, usually.
Unilever, P&G, and a couple of other big ones. I can't remember, but they're the two main big ones. Magnum ice creams are owned by Unilever, for fuck's sake. I found that the other day. We try and avoid Unilever in our house because the
good luck with that.
I know.
You're
try.
Trying to avoid 3M.
My hair shampoo, I've been using it for years, and that's Unilever, you know? It's everywhere, but the reason we try and avoid it is because they do animal testing. We're not particularly, you know, we're not exactly hippies or anything like that, but animal testing is a completely pointless thing to do in general, so we're kind of against it. But you
it's
can't
not
really
pointless,
avoid
otherwise
it.
Otherwise, I wouldn't do it.
There are
it's
arguments
nasty,
for and against,
but
that isn't what this show's about. But
no, it's not.
Let's move on. Anyway, on that note, unless you guys have got anything else to say, I shall close the show.
No, I'm good.
Well, thank you very much for everybody in chat. It's been quite an active chat today, and thank you for contributing. We will hopefully be back maybe next week, maybe not. No, definitely not next week because I'm on holiday, unless these guys want to do it without me. Which
I have no idea how to do it.
Probably won't be able to because they're all useless.
I'll be playing Metal Gear Solid, mate.
And Sam will be playing Metal Gear Solid. The week after that, I'll probably be playing Metal Gear Solid as well. So no Minecraft or Terraria for at least 3 or 4 months.
That's all right. I'll just have a wank instead.
but yes, thank you very much, everyone, for watching, and we'll see you if not the week after next, then whenever. Catch you later, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.